Right, so in the today's session, we are going to learn about overloading, and we will see about this keyword, how to use this keyword, and then we'll talk about the static keywords, so static variables and static methods in Java. So first, let us start with the overloading. So in object-oriented programming, so there is we have discussed about class and object concept. We have discussed about class and object and their object methods. So along with this, we have one more concept in object-oriented programming called as a polymorphism. Okay, polymorphism. This is another concept we have in object-oriented programming. So what polymorphism will say is, if I create something, suppose if I say a method, let's say, if I create a method called m1, so we can use this method for multiple purposes. Not multiple purposes, because sometimes we can just instead of creating multiple methods, suppose I want to add two numbers, or I want to add three numbers sometimes, or I want to add five numbers sometimes like this. So how many methods we require to create for adding these numbers? Normally we need to create multiple methods. So for this we have to create one method. For this, we have to create one more method. For this, we need to create one more method, right? So what polymorphism will say is, instead of creating multiple methods for multiple combination of data, let's have only one method, okay? So what is the concept is, instead of creating multiple methods, right, M1, M2, M3, so let's have only one method, which will take multiple parameters. Like we can pass 2 plus 3, we can pass 3 parameters, we can pass 4 parameters. But still here also we have multiple methods, like same method, we will recreate again and again. But one method will take 2 parameters, the other method will take 3 parameters, some other method will call for 4 parameters and 5 parameters, so on. So what is the difference between the first method and second method is, in the first method, we are creating M1, M2, M3, the methods are different. Okay, the methods are different. Each method is taking a different number of parameters, but they do the same purpose. But here, the second approach, this is our second approach, we have same method name, but every method is taking different parameters. So this is called as an overloading concept. If I create a same method again and again with multiple sets of input, okay, so that's called as the overloading. But what is the advantage we'll get with this is, if I create multiple methods like M1, M2, M3, so on, it will occupy separate memories. So M1 required memory, M2 is required memory, M3 is also required in memory. But if I create only one method multiple times, it will create only one memory. Okay, one memory location it will create, and whichever parameters we are passing, and that particular method will be executed. Suppose when I pass 2 parameters, it will execute this method. And if I pass 3 parameters, then it will execute another method. So based on the number of parameters, order of parameters, data type of parameters, it will choose appropriate method. So this is called as an overloading concept. Okay. So this comes under the polymorphism. So polymorphism says, just create only one thing and which will assist you for multiple purposes. That's the main concept of polymorphism. Okay. Create only one thing which will assist you multiple purposes. So instead of creating many things. So this can be called as an overloading concept. So polymorphism is a concept. Overloading is an approach by which we can achieve the polymorphism. Okay. So in Java, polymorphism is an object-oriented concept. What polymorphism will say is, we can just create only one thing which can be assisted from many things. That's the main concept of polymorphism. But how we can achieve this polymorphism? Through overloading concept, we can achieve the polymorphism. Again, we have two types of overload. So we can overload methods, Java methods we discussed yesterday, and we can also overload constructors. So we already covered about constructor concept, right? What is the difference between method and constructor? Constructor name should be same as a class name. It doesn't return any value and it will automatically invoke at the time of object creation. That's all about constructor. So we can overload methods, and also we can overload constructors. So we can use this overloading concept on methods as well as constructors. Okay, so let me just write some notes here. So what is overloading? Overloading means creating methods with the same name. Creating methods with the same name with multiple parameters or with the different parameters. Different parameters. So this is the concept of overloading. So creating methods with the same name, all methods having same name, but the parameters will be different. So that's the main overloading concept. So we can create a methods or constructors. Methods or constructors. So the overloading concept will applicable for methods as well as constructor. But here, what is an advantage we will get? One is it saves the memory. Okay, it saves the memory. The other one is it will also saves our time. We don't need to create multiple methods. So same method will create multiple time, but only thing is we need to pass some parameters, different parameters. But here we need to follow certain rules. So normally if I create a class, let me just open one more window. Right, so when I create a class, class contains methods, right? So for example, let's say a class called as ABC, and in this class I will have multiple methods, right? So what overloading will say is we have to create multiple methods with the same name. That's the concept of overloading. So when I say first method called, let's say sum, okay, so this method will take two parameters, let's say int x and int y. So two parameters is taken. We'll implement this body later. And similarly, I can also define one more method called same name. Name should be same, but here we should not have the same number of parameters, same data type parameters. So here we need to follow certain rules, because how will Java will identify these methods uniquely? But suppose if I call the sum method from the main method, which method will be called? So we have so many methods with the same name, but which method it will choose, how it will differentiate uniquely. And here we need to follow certain rules. Okay, so based on those rules, this will identify the exact method. So there are two rules we need to follow. So one is, okay, one is data number of arguments. It will differentiate all the methods by depending on number of arguments or number of parameters. That's the first differentiation. Suppose when I call this sum method, okay, it can find more number of methods here in the class, but how it will choose exact method based on number of parameters? The first priority will give you number of parameters. So for example, this is taking two parameter or integer type, and this is taking three parameters, let's say int x, int y and int z. So it's taking three parameters, x, y and z. Now here I'm passing two parameters, let's say 10 comma 20. Now how it will differentiate these two methods? So whichever method is taking two parameters, so that method will be called. Okay, that's the first preference. So number of arguments it will choose. So based on number of arguments, it will choose appropriate method. But suppose sometimes number of arguments or parameters also same. Okay, so here also let's say it is also taking two parameters, but which method it will choose? And second time it will take the data type of those parameters. Data type of parameters. So it will consider data type of parameters. So data type should be different. So suppose here int and x, int y, but here this will be int and this will be double or float. Or the first parameter will be double and second parameter will be int, or both parameters will be double. Okay, that way we can differentiate. The first one is the number of parameters, and the second one is data type of parameters. Okay, these are two important things we need to consider when you create methods, when you use overloading concept. Okay, these rules will be applicable for method overloading and also constructor overloading. Okay, so let us see how we can do this through programmatically. So let me just open my Eclipse. So here this is our Java project. So I'm going to create a new package for today. Day 6. Today is day 6, right? Yeah. So day 6. So here I'm going to create. First I'll show you method overloading, and then we'll see constructor overloading. So let's create a new class. I will name it as a method overloading. Okay, so in this class, main method is there. So let's keep this main method one side. So I will create a few more other methods. Okay, so in the main method overloading, what is the overloading says, like, we can have a method which will take different kinds of parameters, multiple entries. So what I will do is, so I will create a few methods here, void add. Okay, so this is the method I'm going to create. So here this method will take int a comma int b. So two parameters taking now, a comma b, both are int, number of parameters are 2, and data type of parameters are int. Now here inside this I will write system dot out dot println. I'll just add these two numbers, a plus b. Okay, this is the first method. Now I will also create the same method again and again by changing number of arguments and number of data types, and 4 times I'm writing here. So here int a int b, and in the second combination I will just say this is int, I will make this as a double. Okay, now we can differentiate this one and this one. Now the third method, I will make both are double. Now you can see each method is unique. If I consider number of parameters or data type of parameter, every method is unique here. And I'll just say last method int c. Okay, so I have created multiple methods here. So every method is unique here. If you observe this, even if you create same thing here, it will throw an error. See, now it's saying there is a duplicate method is available. So we have to change this. We have to make sure every method is unique. So the first method will take 2 parameters, but one is int, the second is also int. And the second method will take again 2 parameters, but the first one is int, the second one is double. And third method is also take 2 parameters, one is double, the other one is also double. And the third method, fourth method is taking 3 parameters. All 3 are int types. Okay, I have created multiple methods. So now let's come to the main method. So what I will do is, from the main method, if I want to access these methods, how to access them? I want to call this method from the main method. How to access them? Can anyone guess? So through using object. So we have to create an object for this class, and then we can access these methods, right? So let's create an object for this class, method overloading, mvo equal to new method overloading. So now I have created an object. So through this object, I can access these methods. Now let us see. When I say mvo dot add, now you can see when I say dot symbol, it's giving 4 add methods. See, first one. So whichever combination we need, so that particular method we can select from here. So let's say first time I will just pass 10 comma 20. Okay, now you guys can say which method will execute. This is, let's say, first method. I'm just giving some number to identify. This is 2, this is 3, and this is 4. So I have 4 different methods. So now I have passed 2 parameters, and both are integers. So which method it will be called? And Navina is asking question. So it is a method name that helps in overloading. So by using the same method name with the different parameters, we are overloading. Exactly, Navina. So that's you're right. So we are calling the same method, but different kinds of parameters. Okay, that's the main concept of overloading. So for each combination, we don't need to write different names. So different methods we don't need to create. If I create different names, and it will occupy a different memory locations. Okay, so to reduce it, we can just have a same name but different parameters. That's called as an overloading concept. Okay, so now you guys can tell. So if I say two parameter, if I send parameters 10 comma 20, so what is the method it will call? Which method it will call? So I have four methods, right? 1, 2, 3, 4 methods. So it will exactly call first method. So why it will call first method? First, it will look into number of parameters. So I have passed two parameters, 10 comma 20. Now in this list, there are three methods we have, which are taking two parameters, right? Again, in these three combinations, it will check for the data type of parameters. So both are ints. So in these three methods, we have only one method created with int types. So the first method will be called. So this will call first method. Now let's run this. So this will give you 30 as an output. Fine. So similarly, I will also call other methods by passing different arguments. Now this time I'll say 10 comma 20 comma 30. So three parameters I'm passing. So in three parameters, we have only one method in this list. That is the fourth method. So this will call fourth method. Now run this. So this is also giving, why it is giving 30? Because we haven't added C here, plus C also we have to add. So now run as Java application. Now it gives you correct output. And similarly, I'll say mvo dot, I will pass one is integer, the other one is double. So let's say 10, and second parameter I'll say 20.5. Okay, first one is integer, the second one is a double. So this will call exactly the second method. So because second method will exactly match with this. So let's say 2. Okay, so this will give you 30.5. And what is left? Third method. So when I pass two doubles, mvo dot add doubles, two doubles, so 10.5 comma 10.0. So I'm passing two doubles. So this will call you the third method. Okay, so 20.5. So this is how we need to use method overloading. So we can create a methods, same method name, but number of parameters and data type parameters should be different. Okay, remember this, because in next sessions we are going to discuss about method overriding. There is another concept called as a method overriding. So people will confuse here, method overloading, overriding, both are completely different concepts. So just for now, just remember this method overloading. So method overriding we'll discuss later. So method overloading means we can just create methods with the same name by using different parameters. Okay, that's a method overloading. And we need to make sure number of parameters should be different and data type of parameters also should be different. So that's a method overloading concept. So I'm just sharing a small presentation here. Now you can see here. So this is concept of method overloading. Based on data type and number of parameters. So based upon number of parameters and data type of parameters, so those methods will be called, required methods will be called. Okay. So now let us see constructor overloading. So we have another concept called as constructor overloading. Constructor overloading. So what about constructor overloading? So in the method overloading, we can create any method, we can just give any name to the method, right? But in constructor, we have to give the same name, like whichever class name you have given, the same name you have to give to the method also, right? So if you do the constructor overloading, it will be like this. Let's say a class called X. Okay, so suppose XYZ is my class name. So the constructor will be like this, right? So the constructor name will be XYZ. I can create multiple constructors like this. Okay, so again, we need to follow the same rules. The data type parameters and number of parameters should be different, and then the constructor will be considered as unique. Okay, so this is constructor overloading. There's only small difference between this one and the method overloading. Suppose if it is a method overloading, we can have any name to the method. So let's say ABC, some XYZ, so some M and O, something. Okay, so here the different, sorry, the same method name, right? ABC and ABC. So in the method overloading, the method name can be anything, but the same method name we have to use for all the methods. But here, constructor overloading, constructor name must be the class name, but we can have any number of constructors here. Okay, that's the difference between method overloading, constructor overloading. So now let me show you one example for constructor overloading. Let's close this. I'll create one more class. I will name it as constructor overloading. Constructor overloading. Let's take main method. Fine. So this is a main method. Let's keep one side. So I will create a few constructors here, multiple constructors. So as I said, constructor overloading, this is the same method name. Again, we have to use method name same. So constructor name should be as the same name as a class name. So this is the first constructor. And here I will pass two parameters, both are int, int A, int B. So again, I will just add these two numbers, system.out.println, I'll just say A plus. And same constructor again, I will create with multiple combinations. So let's say this is two parameters. This is also two parameters, but double type. And here I'll say double, and this is int. This is the, again, different parameter. See now, what is the difference between these two? Here two parameters, here two parameters. And but here the data type is different. Here the first parameter is int, here the first parameter is double. Okay, here the first second parameter is double, and here the second parameter is int. We can also differentiate like this, and we can also create one more. Let's say int, int B, and also I create int C. Okay, so here I will add C also. Fine. So I have created multiple constructors with the different number of parameters and different number of data types. Now, if you want to call this constructor, how we can call them? How to call constructor? So we don't need to create any object for them. Okay, so we just create an object, automatically it will invoke. So we don't need to call explicitly, unlike a method. Okay, so just I create an object for this class. Constructor overloading CO equal to new constructor overloading. Okay, observe this carefully. When I create an object here for this class, it's giving an error. So new constructor overloading. Why it is giving an error? So by default, this will invoke a default constructor. But in this class, we don't have any default constructor. What is the default constructor? If a constructor doesn't take any parameters, that's called a yes. If method doesn't have any parameters, so that's called as a default constructor. But we don't have a default constructor in this method, in this class, so it is giving an error. So we must pass some parameters here, unless until it will not allow us. So here I'll just pass two integers, so 10 comma 20. So now this command automatically invokes the first constructor. So this is the first constructor. Let us say this is 2 and this is 3, this is 4. So this will call a first constructor. So if you want to call another constructor, we must create another object, or we can pass parameters here itself. So for example, here I'll pass 3 parameters now, 30. So first let us execute this. 10 comma 20. So now it gives a correct output. So now if I say 30 here, this will call a fourth constructor, because there is only one constructor which will take 3 parameters. So this will call fourth constructor. And if I say 10.5, this is a double, and the second one is integer. 10.5 is a double, 20 is an integer. So this will call third constructor. So 30.5, and similarly you can say this is a integer and second parameter I'll say a double. From as Java application, now it will call this method, second constructor. Okay, so this is also called as a overloading concept applied on constructors, method overloading and constructor overloading. Okay, so guys, are you clear what is overloading, how to achieve method overloading and constructor overloading? So this is a simple concept. Now I have one question too, guys. We also have the main method, right? So in your class we are also having the main method. So main is also a method just like other methods, but we have we can overloaded methods, like in the previous example. So we have overloaded methods, but main is also a method, right? So can we overload this main method? Can anyone guess? Can we overload this main method? Can we write multiple main methods in the same class? So can we overload this main methods in the same class? And the answer is yes, we can create the main method again and again, but we have to change the syntax. Okay, we should not create another main method with the same syntax. We should change the syntax, okay? And number of parameters should be changed. In those cases, we can overload main method, okay? So let me just show you one example. So overload main method, this is an interview question, okay? So just remember this. So overload main method, I will just say overload main method. So this is a actual main method. Execution will start from here. I will write code later here. So for now I'm just creating few main methods, but here I said a definition should be different. So here I will create a main method, let's say public void main. So this public is optional, okay? This is access modifier, so we don't need to have this public, or if you have, no problem. But we can also have, we don't have the static keyword, okay? Because static keyword having a different functionality, I will just talk about this in few minutes, so don't consider this static. So public void static. But whenever we create a main method, we should not use these three combinations, okay? Public static void. Static is removed, right? So no problem. Now this main method is take is a one parameter. Let's say it take one parameter, let's say x, and here I will just print that parameter, system dot out dot println of x. Okay, so this is the first main method, and I'll also create one more main method, let's say public void main. So this time it will take two parameters, let's say int x comma int y. So here it will add two numbers, system dot out dot println x plus y. Okay, this is another main method. So this is the actual main method. Okay, so Preeti is asking question, will the execution start from the default main method always? Yes, so always Java is look for this syntax. So you can have any number of methods in the class, doesn't matter, but always JVM or Java Virtual Machine is always look for this method, this particular method. So Java itself is written like that initially. Okay, so Java will understand only this particular main method. So whichever, whenever, wherever it defines this, the execution will start from here. Okay, that's mandatory thumb rule. So now, so we have created two main methods, and Urvashi is asking question, and these methods should be created before static main method. No, you can also have this method after this. The order of writing methods are not important in class. So within the class, so you can create methods anywhere, okay? But these methods should be outside of main method. So don't worry, don't confuse here. One method should not contain another method, okay? Each and every method is independent. So this main method is different, this main method is different, and this is the actual main method. Okay, remember this. Okay, so And this main method also can have in another class. Yesterday we have seen, right, this main method also can be there in another class, then we can call this main method. So one more thing, so these methods can be created before actual main method like this, or we can create them after main method like this. The order of creation of methods are not important. So in wherever you have created these methods, so always execution will start from the main method. Okay, remember this. Okay, so I'll create here. Fine. So now here I have done two main methods. I have created two main methods. One main method is taking one parameter, and the second main method will take two parameters. Okay. Now how to call these main methods now? How to call these main methods? So we must create an object. Okay, there is no other way. So let's create an object for this class. Method overloading, overload main method. So let's say OM equal to new main overload main method. Okay, so now using this object, I must call these two main methods. So I'll just say OM dot main. Now you can see here it's giving three main methods. This is actual main method, but along with this, we have these two methods. So we can call these two methods main. Here I'll just say 100, and what this will do, it should print the value of 100. So this will go and store in x, and it is printed that value. So this will call first main method. Let's say give some number to this. This is the first one, this is the second one. So this will call first one. Similarly, om dot main, I'll pass two parameters. So let's say 100 and 200. Okay, this will call second main method, run as Java application. Okay, so this is how we can also overload a main method. Okay, so Navina is asking question, can we access methods of one object in another object? Can we access methods from one object in another object? No, Navina, each and every object is independent, I said, right? So there is nowhere related. So just remember the yesterday's concept again. So we cannot do that. So every object is independent. As I said yesterday, this is a class. Let's say this is your class. Okay, class contains variables and methods, right? M1, M2, M3. So as soon as you created an object, so let's say this is object 1, this is an object 2. So as soon as you created object for this class, this object will acquire its own copy of these variables. Let's ABC, M1, M2, M3. So these are all different, and object 2 is also acquired its own copy of this class. Like again, it is also getting ABC, M1, M2, M3. So these objects are nowhere related. Okay, everything is different, but we can share classes. Yes. So the class, based on the class, we can create any number of objects. All objects are derived from the class, but these objects are completely independent. There is nowhere related. Okay, this having its own memory location, the object 2 is having its own memory location. We cannot club these two together. Okay, so no, even though the publics or variables are public or methods are public, we cannot access between these two objects. So these access modifier, public means we have another class, for example. Okay, so let's say this is class 1, this is class 2. And now these variables and these methods can be accessed in another class. This is the context of public. Okay. So if I create one class, we can access those variables and methods in another class, which this is a different class. But within the objects, we cannot club these two together because these two are completely independent. Okay. Now you got it. Why public works? Public is different context. When I say public for these variables and methods, these variables and methods can be accessed in another class, but not an object. Okay. So that's the context. Public, I'll talk about these access modifiers in the coming session. See, public is an access modifier. Okay. Public says, what is the scope of that variable? So from where and where we need to access that, we can access that variable. So that is basically decided by the public. So we have private, public, default, protected. There are some access modifiers. Okay, so I will talk about in the coming sessions. There are four access modifiers. For now, just remember public is a simple and access modifier. If I say public, that way those variables and methods can be accessed in any other class, in any other packages, and everywhere, almost everywhere. Okay, so public is a completely very high level public. We have a after public, we have a protected, we have a default, we have a private. So these access modifiers will restrict the access levels. Suppose, for example, I don't want to access these variables and methods in another class. Just I want to make them as a private. So in that particular case, I cannot access them in another class. Okay. Suppose I want to access only this class and this class. I don't want to access them in another packages. And then I can make it as a default. So in that case, we cannot access them in another packages, but still we can access them within the same class. So this is again a little bit a huge concept. So it will take again one more session. Okay, so I will just talk about coming sessions. So just for now, please ignore this. Okay, so public means is an access modifier. It will just restrict the access levels. So more than public, we don't have any other access modifier. So public is a very high level, means we can access those variables and methods in within the class, outside of the class, within the package, outside of the package, everywhere in the project. Okay, that's a public. So where are we now? So we are discussing about the main method, right? So this is about the main method. So can we overload the main method? Yes, we can overload the main method. Okay, clear everyone? So now I'll move on to the next concept, very important. Now we are going to discuss about the static key. And before that, I will also going to show you this keyword. So let's talk about this keyword. What is this keyword? Where we need to use this keyword? So let me just show you one example. First, let us identify the problem. And there is some problem when you do overloading concept. Okay. So if you overcome that particular problem, we use this keyword. Let me show you where it can be applicable. So let's take either it can be applicable is method overloading or constructor overloading, wherever it is fine. And just again, I'm taking I can take a previous example, or also I can take, let me create one more or else. So I'll name this as this keyword main method. Okay, so here I'll create a normal, I'll just create a few class variables, let's say int a comma b. So you can also create multiple variables in the same line. Okay, this is also right. Just a moment. Okay, so now I have created two different variables. Now I'll create a method, or you can create also a constructor, that is up to you. So I'll just create a method called void add. This will take two parameters, int, some called x, some called y, and here x will be assigned to the a and then y is assigned to the b. Okay, this is my method. And I'll also create or else I'll just give some different name, get values. Okay, and this will get x and y and I'll assign to a and b. Now I'll create one more method here. I'll say void print values. I'll create one more method called print values. So what this method will do is, this method will print the values of a and b. So here I will print system dot out dot println. I'll just print value of a and system dot out dot println. I just print value of b. So these are the two methods I have. And if you want to call these two methods, I need to create an object in the class. If it is a constructor, we don't require. So I'll just create an object for this class, this keyword. I'll just say th is an object name is equal to new this keyword. Fine. So now I will call the first method get values. Okay, th dot get values. So we need to pass two parameters, right? So I'll say 10 comma 20 I'm passing, and then 10 is assigned to the x and again reassigned to the a. 20 will be assigned to the y and reassigned to the b here. And these x and y called as a method variables. Okay, and Preeti is asking a question, can we ask for the values from user at the runtime? Yes, we can still ask, Preeti, but I haven't introduced that concept so far. We need to use a scanner class, we need to create one more object. There is a process to accept input from the user. Okay, we need to write multiple statements here. So that is the reason I haven't told you. Okay, I'll just show you in today's session or tomorrow's session. Okay, that's a very simple one. But that is not much easy like C, C++. In C++, C, C++, we have a scanf or printf statement, right? So it is with single statement, we can get the input from the user there. But here we need to write multiple statements. Okay, so that's the reason I'm just passing it. We can still take the input from the user. Fine, so here 10 comma 20 will be assigned to the x and y. And since over here print values will be print those values of a and b. Now I'll call th dot print values. Okay, this is the method. Now when I run this code, what is an output we will expect? So when I run this code, I will expect 10 comma 20. So this is our expected output. Fine. Now what I will do is, if you observe here, so a, e, b are called as instance variables. Okay, or class variables. We can call them as an instance variable or class variables. And here we are using different variables, right? X and y are the different variables. So these are all called method variables. These are called a method variable or external variables. Okay, so here the question is, we have a and b internally as a class name or class variables. And here, instead of using different variable names, can we use the same variable's name here? Can anyone guess? Can we use the same names here? So here, I'm just giving the different names, x and y. So why should I give the different names? Can we give the same names here? Yes, we can still give the same names here, a and b. Okay. So A and B have a given. So now if I give A and B, what should we do now? This A should be assigned to the class variable and this B should be assigned to the class variable B. So here I will just replace A and B. Okay. So is it correct? Can anyone guess? So I have just used the same variable names here. And now here class variable names and method variable names also same I have used. And again internally, normally whatever variables we get here will reassign to the class variables. I have done the same thing here. Okay, so here. Okay, so here normally we know about these two are the class variables, A and B. And whichever variables we define within this class, within the method as a parameters, they are called as a method variables or external variables. Okay, outside of this method, whichever variable is created, there comes under the class variables or instance variables. Okay, now this program is syntactically correct. There is no issue in this, but it is not correct logically. So when I run this code, observe this, what it is returning. It's written 0 and 0. It's not giving us as per our expected, right? So why it is giving 0 and 0? Why? Because here we are using same variable names a comma b, but here we can still use it, no problem in this. But here at the time of assignment, what method is doing is, the method is doesn't know about this. What is a is equal to a, I'm saying, right? So a is equal to a means which a is belongs to class, which a is belongs to method variable. It cannot differentiate by this method. Okay, this method is not able to differentiate which A is belongs to class, which A is belongs to method, and which B is belongs to class, which B is belongs to method. So basically this method is not able to differentiate them. So that is the reason it is giving the default values are zero. Okay, this is the problem in this. But still I want to use the same variable names. I don't want to go for different names, but still I want to achieve my task. So how we can do that? So simply just say using this keyword. Here just use this keyword. This dot A equal to A, this dot B equal to B. So what this will represent, this is represents, this will say, okay, this A is belongs to class and this B is belongs to class. So this keyword is representing that particular variable or belong that particular variable or variables or belongs to that particular class. Okay, now this keyword is representing, this keyword is differentiating. So now the class or method will know about which variable is belongs to method, which variable is belongs to class. Okay, now we'll run this code, you will get exact output. So this is how we need to use this keyword. So when we need to go and use this keyword, if you want to use the method variables names exactly same as the variable names, then you can differentiate them by using this keyword. Okay, so Rishi is asking question, so why can't we just use separate variables? You can still use separate variables, but as I said earlier, every variable will occupy certain amount of memory. Okay, every variable is occupying certain amount of memory. So whenever you are creating a program, or if you do some programming, we should avoid a number of variables. Okay, we should always avoid number of variables. So we always make sure a minimum number of variables we must use always. We always trying to reduce the number of variables. Okay, so just like array. So yesterday we have discussed about array concept, right? So if you want to declare 10 variables, 10 numbers, I should create 10 variable names like this, A, B, C, D, so on, right? So instead of creating these number of variables, I can just create one array which contains all the values. So how this we used to reduce? It creates only one memory location. But if I create more number of variables, the maintenance is very tough and also it will occupy a lot of memory space. So that is the reason we need to always prefer to reduce the number of variables. So that is the reason we have to use like this. And Preeti is asking question, this points to class variables or yes. Whenever this keyword is used, that particular variable is always points to class variables. Okay. So that's the usage of this keyword. So whenever you want to use method variables exactly the same as a class variables, then if you want to differentiate them, method variable and class variable, if you want to differentiate them, you must use this keyword. So this dot A means this A variable is belongs to class, and this dot B means this B is belongs to class, and other A and B are belongs to method. Okay. So Preeti, is it clear now? Fine. So this is all about this keyword, and this keyword can be used in constructor also. So instead of method, if I create a constructor, so there also you can use the same variable names here. And but internally, how we can differentiate this method variables and class variables by using this keyword. Okay, this is same concept again applicable for constructor also. So remember this, very important, and this keyword can be used like that. Now let's go for the last concept, static variables and static methods. This is very important for us, static variables and static methods. So far we are using the main method as a static, but exactly we don't know what is static and right. So now we are going to discuss this, what is static and static methods. So let me just give you a small use case where the static will be applicable. So let me just share a small presentation. Okay, so static is a keyword can be applicable for method and also a variables. Okay, static keyword can be applicable for variables and methods. So we can create static variables and we can create static methods. But what is an advantage of it? Where we need to use static? So what is exactly use case? So let me just show you the context here. So observe this picture. So I have a small class called as employee class here, which contains a few variables called emp number, ename, department number, and there is also a method called as a bonus. So employees class contains these variables and a method. Now I have created multiple objects for the same class. So here emp1 is one object, emp2 is another object, emp3 is also another object. So as soon as I created object, it will get its own copy of variables and methods. So now if you observe this emp1, it's having emp number, e name, department number and bonus. And emp2 also having its own variables and method. And emp3 is also having its own variables and methods. Okay. And this is a context, basic concept we have understood already. So there is a scenario, for example, okay, this is just like a scenario, okay, it's not always applicable, static will not applicable always, okay. And some scenarios, I'm going to show you one use case here, okay. In this use case, suppose, let us assume these three objects or these three employees are belongs to same department number. So these three employees are belongs to same department number. Let us say department number is 10. So all three employees, for each employee I have created different object. So all three employees are belongs to same department number, that is 10. So in this case, what happens is we need to assign the values for every variable, right? So this is common thing. So when I create an object emp1, I will assign some values to these variables. Emp number is 101. Name is John, department number is 10, bonus method I will call, and EMP number 102, E name, department number and bonus, and EMP 23 also I need to define the value. So EMP number, E name, department number and bonus. So each individual object we need to assign values of those variables. Okay, till now it is fine, but here the problem is, suppose any variable, let's say department number, is same for every object. Okay, department number is same for every object. So when I assign the values like this, EMP1 I have assigned department number 10, EMP2 also I have assigned department number 10, EMP3 also I have assigned department number 10. So suppose if I create 100 objects like this, in 100 places I need to assign this value. So if I do this approach, there are two problems. Okay, if I do this approach, there are two problems. But other variables are fine because other values are different. Here this is 101, this is 102, this is 103. And name is also different and bonus is different. But when this is applicable, if the value is same for that particular variable for every object, then the problem. So there are two issues here. The one issue is, as I said, whenever we create an object, it will occupy a certain amount of memory. EMP1 memory is different, EMP2 memory is different, EMP3 memory is different. Again, each individual variable is also occupies certain amount of memory. So here EMP number will get some memory, E name, DPT number, bonus, each and every variable and the value will occupy certain amount of memory in your system. So like this. So if I create this in this approach, as I said, every object is occupying memory, so that every variable is also occupying same certain amount of memory. If I have 100 objects like this, okay, and if I assign this variable 100 times, so how much space it will occupy? Lot of space is occupied. Okay, lot of space is wasted because every object here, DPT number 10 required a memory. Let's say here occupied 2 KB of space, and here it is also occupied 2 KB of space. Here also it is occupied 2 KB of space. So if you count like this, it will be finally lot of memory will be occupied. This is the first problem. The second problem, suppose tomorrow all these employees are moved to some other department number. Okay, all these employees are moved to some other department number, and in that case what I should do now, again I should change this value in each and every object. So suppose it becomes 20 now. So I need to go and change here 20, 20, 20, 20, so on. All 100 objects I need to change it here. So these are the two different problems. These are the two different problems. One is it will occupy the lot of memory. The second thing is if I change, suppose tomorrow if any changes happens, then that change should affect in all other objects. But we need to go and modify each and every object. So that is the problem. So to overcome these two problems, so static will come into the picture. So what are the two problems? Every object occupies certain amount of space in the memory, so that every variable is also occupy the memory. That's the one problem. Second is objects are independent. So these objects are completely independent. There is nowhere related. So if I modify the variable value object one here, that suppose it becomes 20 now. Here I modify it as a 20, that will not affect on other objects because every object is independent. So we need to go and modify this value in every object. So that is another problem we have. So how we can overcome these two problems? By using static. Now let us see this scenario. So what is that variable which is common for all the objects? Department number, right? So instead of assigning this department number 10 each and every object, what I will do is I will just assign the value here itself. Okay, I'll make that variable as a static. Now what happens? So in the class level itself, in the class level, when I'm creating a variable, I will directly assign the value here, 10. And then I will make that variable as a static. So when I say that variable as a static, it will create a separate memory location. And here the debit number 10 will be stored. This is a shared memory. This is called as a shared location. As soon as I make a static variable, this will create a separate memory location. There department number 10 will be stored. Now, so let's create three different objects now. EMP1, EMP2 and EMP3. Now EMP1 is created. It's getting its own copy of variables and method, right? So EMP number is assigned 101. Ename and bonus also we have assigned. But what about DEPT number? The same DEPT number will be applicable for this object EMP1. Okay, if still you want to change, you can change it later, but this DEPT number 10 will be applicable to EMP1. And if I create EMP2, the same DEPT number 10 will be applicable to EMP2, and the same again applicable for EMP3 also. So what does that mean is every object will share the same department number 10. So this department number 10, this is only one memory space. Here let's say it's a 2 KB it is taking. But here again, it will not occupy the memory. So, but previous example here 2 KB, 2 KB, 2 KB and so on it's going. But this time, as soon as I make it as a static, this creates a separate memory location. There the static keyword will be stored. Okay, now this variable is shared across all the objects. As soon as you created this object, this DEPT number 10 will be applicable for EMP1, EMP2, EMP3 and so on. Or this is your shared memory. Okay, so this one will solve one problem. What is that problem? It saves the memory. It saves the memory because here we are not assigning the value to department number. In each and every object, we are not assigning the value. But here at the class level, we just say static, it creates a new memory. And here that variable and value will be stored. And the same variable and value will be shared across all the objects. Now, this is a common variable for all the objects. All the objects are shared this variable. That's the first problem. So first problem is solved. It saved memory. Now the second problem. Suppose a DPT number is changed. Suppose these employees are moved to some other department number called 20. Now, just change in the class level itself. And Naveen is asking question, does that mean we have to use static variable in all the methods in class, all the methods in class? Yes. So static is a one-time keyword, Navina. So if I say a variable as a static, that becomes a static. It creates a separate memory. Suppose if you still want to use this variable, yeah, in this class. Yes, in this class, you can still use this variable just like other variables. Okay. Just for wait for a few minutes because I haven't completed this. So once I have completed this complete static, then you can ask your questions. Okay, because whatever questions you are asking you is I'm going to cover them in few minutes. Okay, let's complete this. Once we have get the complete picture, and then if you have still have any questions, you can ask me now. So just I'm in the middle of this. Okay, so we have discussed about two issues. One is a memory issue, because if I initiate that variable in each and every object, that will create the memory. But when I say a variable as a static, this create a different location, and every object is shared this particular variable. Okay, this becomes a shared location now. That will solve the memory issue. The second issue is, suppose tomorrow these employees have changed the department, moved to some other department. Now, what I can do is, we can do two things. One is, we can change this value at the class level. Okay, just modify this value at the class level. That will automatically affect change here. So every object will be affected. Every object is affected. So we no need to go and change in every object. That is not at all required. Okay, that's the one way of updating. The second way is, suppose if you don't want to update here, so you can update that value by using any one of these objects. Suppose here emp1.department20 have modified here, that will automatically affect other objects also. Here becomes 20, here it is also become 20. Why? Because this is a shared variable. So if I change here, that will automatically affect here. If I change in the class level also, it will affect here. So even we can also modify this value by using emp2, by using emp3, and by using any one of these objects. Or you can directly modify in the class, that will automatically affect here. Because this is a common variable or shared variable across the class and all the objects. Even though objects are independent, they are nowhere related, but the static variable and static methods are common across all the objects. Okay, so guys, are you clear now how to use this static keyword? So there are two advantages when you use static. So when I say variable or method also, we can define as a static. So when I say variable or method as a static, that will create a separate location and that will become a shared variable or shared method across all the objects. It will solve two problems. We no need to assign this value in each and every object. Second problem, suppose tomorrow the values change, we can just change here itself. Automatically, all the objects will be affected by this value. Or we can change this value by using any one of these objects that will automatically affect in other objects also. So this is a concept of static. Internally, the static will work like that. So this is a use case where the static will be applicable. We should not use static in always, okay? Whenever, wherever it is required. So there and all, we have to declare a variable or method as a static. Okay, so the concept is clear, everyone. Please confirm. I'll show you one example on this. So where we need to use static and how to use this. Okay, but if I create a variable or method as a static, so we have set an access level limits. Okay, let me show you how we can access these static variables and all. So let's go to the program. So I will create another class to demonstrate a static keyword. So please focus on this. I'll name it as a static example. Static example. Let's take a main method. Okay, so can anyone tell main is a static method or non-static method? Main is a static method or non-static method? Can anyone guess? Yes, main is a static method because we have a static keyword here, right? So anything. So if variable or method, if it mentioned as a static keyword, that will be considered as a static methods and static variables. Okay, if it is a variable, that is called a static variable. If I say static for method, that method is a static method. If I don't specify static, those methods and variables are considered as a non-static variables and non-static methods. Okay, so here two things we need to discuss. Okay, static variables and static methods. Static variables and static methods. So I'm going to show you three important points here. So within the class we can have static variables and static methods and non-static variables and non-static methods. That is up to you, whichever you want this define. Okay, so what I can do is I'll just mention three important points here, and before that let me just create a few methods and variables here. I'll create a variable called int a is equal to 10. So this is a normal variable. I make this as a static variable. Okay, now it becomes a static variable. As soon as I say static, it changes to italic. and this is your static variable. Static variable. Now I'll get one more variable, int b equal to, I'll say 20. I don't specify static keyword for this, so this is non-static variable. Non-static variable. One is static variable, the other one is non-static variable. And similarly, I will also create one static method, the other one is non-static method. So if I create a method void, let's say m1, this is a method, and here I will write some message system.out.println. And I will make this as a static. Okay, so then this method becomes a static method. This is a static method. So here I will just write some message. This is a m1 static method. Okay, some message I have given. So this is your static method. Now I will also create one more method called non-static method. So let's say void m2. Okay, so this is non-static. Non-static. So inside this method, I will write system.out.println, and this is m2, which is non-static method. Non-static method. Okay. So let's finish this in double quotations. Fine. So now I have created two variables. One is static variable, the other one is non-static variable. And similarly, I created two different methods. One is static method, the other one is non-static methods. Okay. Now, main is also static method. Okay. Everything will start from the main method, right? So keep this main method open. So I'll tell you a few points here. Just remember, very important. The first point is, I'll talk about static method first. Okay. Static methods can access only static stuff. Okay, remember this point. Static methods can access only static stuff. Means static variables and static methods. So this is a direct access. Directly. It's directly. What does that mean is, so static methods can access only static stuff. Only static stuff. It cannot access any other non-static stuff. So static methods are always access only static stuff, and this is a direct access. What is direct access? Without creating any object. Even we don't need to create any object. We can still access those variables and methods. So let me show you. So static variables or static methods can access only static stuff. Okay, just remember this point. Come back to your program. So main is a static method, right? So I will tell you now. Static methods can access only static stuff. So main is a static method. Now I'm trying to access static variable and static method from the main method. That's the first point. So static methods can access only static stuff. So let us see whether it is able to access or not. So main is a static method. So A is a static variable, M1 is also static method. So let us see, can we access them directly or not without creating any object. Okay, that's the main meaning of direct. So here, direct I'm accessing. So how we can access? I'll just say system.out.println. Okay, just I will print the value of A. That's it. So here I haven't created any object. Observe this. So did we create any object here? No. Directly I'm accessing this variable here. Okay. Now it prints direct value here. So it prints value of 10. Because without creating any object, I'm directly able to access this A. Similarly, I can also directly call this M1 because this is also static. Main is also static. Variable is also static. This M1 is also static. So directly we can call M1 like this. So we don't need to create any object. So when I run this, it will also call M1 method. So this is an output for M1 method. So what we understood based on this is static methods can access static variables, static methods directly. This is a direct access. But we cannot access non-static stuff. So main is a static method and b is a non-static variable. This is a non-static variable and m2 is a non-static variable. So let's try. So if you want to print a b value, okay, it's giving an error. So why it is giving an error? If I put here, it is saying cannot make a static reference to the non-static field b. So what is it saying is main is a static method so that you can access only static variables. You cannot access non-static. So if you still want to access, change this as a static. Change b as a static. So this is a suggestion it is giving. So this statement is incorrect. Incorrect. So why? Because b is non-static variable. B is a non-static variable. Similarly, if I try to call m2 directly, it's giving the same error again. So change m2 to static. So m2 is a non-static so that I'm not able to access directly. So this is also incorrect. This is also incorrect because m2 is non-static method. Okay. So as per the first point, static methods can access only static stuff. This is a direct access. We cannot access non-static stuff. We can access only static stuff. So directly means without creating an object. Without creating an object. That's the meaning of a direct access. Okay. Fine. So suppose this main method is present in some other class. This method is present in some other class. But can we call like this directly? Still we can call directly, but just we need to specify the class name. So class name dot a, class name dot method. So we can directly specify the class name and then we can use it. So what is the difference? If you have main method within the same class, we can directly access, even with, we don't need to specify the class name. But suppose this main method is present in some other class, then you can still access this variable and method, but we need to specify the class name. But then also you don't need to create an object. Still that is a direct access. So static variables and static methods we can directly access by using class. We don't require an object. Okay, but in this context, in the first point. So when you're trying to access static variables and static method from the static methods, you can directly access without creating an object. So this is the first point. So static methods can access static stuff directly without creating any object. So guys, are you clear at this point? So please confirm on the chat window, then I'll move on to the next point. So you have to be very clear on this. Okay, this is the first point. So static methods can access static stuff directly. It cannot access non-static stuff. I show you both the ways, right? Now, second point. In the second point, what I'm saying is static methods can also access static stuff, but through object it is possible. Through object. This is the second point. In the first point is completely contradictory statement. In the second point, right? What in the first point I'm saying, static methods can access only static stuff without creating any object, direct access. But in the second point, what I'm saying is static methods can also access static stuff. But how it is possible? Through object it is possible. Here we must create an object. Okay, so static method can also access static stuff, but through object it is possible. Through object it is possible. So let us see how this point will work. Through object, it is possible. This is the second point. Here I'm writing. So static methods can also access static stuff, but through object it is possible. So now I'm trying to access this main is a non-static method. Sorry, main is a static method. Now I'm trying to access non-static. So what are the non-static we have here? B is a non-static variable. M2 is also non-static method. So if you want to access them directly, it's giving an error. We already tried it, right? If I try to access them directly, it's giving an error. Now I will try to access them through object. So now we need to create object for this class. Static example, SE is equal to new static example. Now through this object we can access. Now SE dot B, I can print this value system.out.println. Now we are able to access this through object. And I will also call SE.m. Okay, so now what I have done is static methods can also access static stuff, but through object. Static methods can also access static stuff. Static methods can also access non-static stuff. Remember this. The first point, static methods can access only static stuff, that is direct, without creating an object. And second point, I'm saying static method can also access non-static. Static method can also access non-static, but through object it is possible. So here initially I have tried accessing non-static, but it is not possible directly. Now I have created this object, and through this object I am calling non-static, that is M2. So first one is B, right? B is a variable. So I'm trying to access this system.out.println SE.b. So now this is a non-static variable. This is non-static variable I have accessed through object. Okay. And similarly, I will also access a non-static method, that is M2. Okay, so see this, what is the difference here? But here we are not able to access non-static stuff directly, but here we are able to access them through object. Okay, now let's run this code. Now you can see that these two are outputs of these two statements. Now these last two are the outputs of these two statements. Okay, this is correct now. So here again we are accessing non-static method, okay, through object. Okay, that's about second point. Again, I'll repeat second point. Static methods can also access non-static stuff, but through object only it is possible. This is not direct access. Okay, so guys, are you clear now? First and second points. If there is any confusion, please ask me now. In first and second points. Okay, so static methods, we have certain restrictions to access other methods. So these are the two restrictions. So static methods can access only static stuff by default without creating any object, that is direct access. But if you still want to access non-static stuff in static methods, we must access them through object. Okay, now I'll tell you third point. So in the first two points I talked about static methods, but what about non-static methods? So non-static methods, we don't have any restrictions. So non-static methods can access both static and non-static stuff directly without creating any objects. So non-static methods, we don't have any restrictions. So non-static method can also access static, non-static, everything, without creating any objects. Okay, we don't have any restrictions. Now let me show you. So main is the static method, we have already done this, keep one side. Now so M1 is static, M2 is a non-static. So along with this I will also create one more method which is non-static, let's say M3. Okay, so what is the third point I'm saying is non-static method can access both static and non-static stuff directly, so no object or requirement. Now in the M3 method, I will try to access these variables. Okay, I'll just say system.out.println A. Now this is a direct access, and also I'll just access B. Now we can see there is no difference here. So this is a static variable, this is a non-static variable. Both I can access directly from non-static method. Similarly, I can also call static method, non-static method directly. So here I will call M1 and here I'll call M2. So there are no restrictions for non-static methods to accessing other methods, but only the restrictions are there for only static methods. Now M3 is created. So how again M3 will call? Until unless we call this M3 method, these will not be executed. These statements will not be executed. So how to call M3 method now? M3 is a non-static method. So how to call M3 method? Again, we need to execute this M3 method from the main method through object. Because M3 is a non-static, main is a static. So here we need to use se.m3. And then M3 will be called, and internally M3 will print a static variable value, non-static variable value, and internally it will execute static and non-static methods. Okay. So here I will also write a message system.out.println. So this is a M3 method, non-static. Okay. Fine. So non-static methods can access both static and non-static stuff directly without creating any objects. We don't have any restrictions for non-static methods. Now run this code. Now see here. So here M3 method is called. This is M3 method, right? So this is an output we are getting. So this is the output we are getting. Now you can see it prints A value 10, B value 20, and M1, M2 again called. So M1, M2 called means this is giving to these two outputs from M1 and M2. Okay. So non-static methods doesn't have any restrictions. So these are all three thumb rules you have to remember whenever you work with the static variables and static methods. So I'll just summarize this, and Preeti is asking question. If static void M1 wants to access int B, which is non-static, how it will access? Okay, let me show you. So what you are accessing, if a static void M1, so you're talking about M1, okay, so this is a static method, wants to access int B. So int B is a non-static, okay, and how it will access? Yes, we can still access. So M1 is a static method, B is a non-static method. So what is the rule for this? Can a static method access non-static variable by default directly? No, it's not access. But how we can access? Through object we should access. Through object we can access. But how to create an object here? So we have to create a static example. SE equal to new static example, and then SE dot, we can access B like this. So here you can print this value, system dot out dot print. So this is how we need to access. So anywhere the same thing. So anywhere the process is same. Okay. So here, if you want, M1 is a non-static method and B is a non-static. So if you want to still access, we must access through an object. Okay, this is possible now. So let's run this. It's give you an output here. But again, this M1 method should be called from the main method. So then only this code, piece of code will be executed. Okay. So here M1 called. Sorry, not here. So here M1 is called, static example M1, first time it is given here. And when I go here M1, okay, so again it is created object for SE. So it is print SE dot B. So B value is printed here. And this is a M1 static method. So here this is a method. So static method M1. Let me just recap it here. So here we call M1 method, static method. From non-static, it will go here. So these are the statements is created. So internally it creates this SE object. Okay, now it prints the B value of SE, and then it gives us this message. This is M1 is a static method. So this is an output for this, and then it will exit. Again, it will go and execute the M2. Okay, so everywhere the concept is same. So if you remember these two rules, the same rules can be applied everywhere. But remember, one more important thing is every time when you create some objects, always you need to create in the main method. Okay, this is not a right approach. So syntactically everything is fine. This is correct. I'm not saying it is wrong, but this is not a best practice. Okay, so because always objects will be created from the main method. not from the normal method. Okay, remember this point. So is it clear, everyone? So I'm just summarizing these points again. So just see this table. It gives you the clear picture. And static methods can access static variables and static methods directly. So this is the direct access, this one and this one. This one and this is the direct access. And static methods can access non-static stuff, yes, but through object. So here we need to use object here and here. This is the first line. And non-static methods can access static methods, non-static methods directly. So there is no restriction. This is the direct access. So remember this table and then it will be very easy for you. Okay. So that's all about the static variables and static methods. So going forward, I'm going to use this static keyword very frequently. And if I say static, those variables can be directly accessed from static methods. That is main method. Okay. So any questions, anyone? So that's all for today here. I'll just stop it here. If you still have any questions, you can ask me. And come to the assignment. Okay, one more thing is pending. I'm just take another 2 to 3 minutes. It's very simple. So far we have used system.out.println, right? So what is this? You need to understand. What is system.out.println? This is the right time to discuss about this method. Because we already know about classes, objects, static keyword, right? So this is the right time to understand. System.out.println. Let's understand this one. System.out.println. This is again depends on static. Okay. So you guys should tell this. Okay. I'll just give an example. So before discussing this system.out.println, I'll give you a small scenario here. Observe this. I have a class called as a test. This is my class. So in this class, I have a string variable. Let's say string. Okay. S. Is equal to, I have assigned some value to this. Okay, this is my a string variable which is created in the class, and this is a static variable. This is a static variable. Okay, this is my class. Test is my class. I have a variable called S. The type of S is string, and it is also static variable, and I have also some value inside it. Okay, this is a structure. Now, if I want to access this variable from outside, and also I want to find length of a string. First, I want to access this variable from outside of this class, and then I want to find length of a string. So how to do this? So I want to access this variable now. How to access this variable? This is a static variable. Can anyone guess how to access this variable called s? So this is a static variable. So how to access the static variables? How to access the static variables? By using class name, right? So we don't need to create anything. So just we need to access this variable by using class name. So how we can write now? How we can write? So can anyone suggest? If you want to access this variable, okay, how to write the statement? Yes, class name dot variable name. Because this is a static variable, we can directly access by using a class. Now, so S is a contains already a value. So I want to find out the length of this string. So how to find out? Followed by your S is a string variable so that I can apply all the string methods. So I will just say length method. Length method. So what this will give you now? So test is a class. S is a string variable of type is static, which contains a value, and length is a method which will find out length of this particular string. So why we have applied this method here? Because string is a, S is a string variable. So we can apply all the string methods on string variables. So that's the reason I have applied length method. So this is a whole statement. In this statement, test is a class. S is a variable of type is string and static, and length is a method, string method. Okay, so this will give you 7 as an output. It returns something, that's a 7. Now let us simulate the same thing for system.out.println. Okay. Now in Java, there is a predefined class called as a system. So in this class, there is a variable called out. Out is a variable. What is the type of this variable? Print stream. Here the S is a string type, but here out is a print stream type. So this is also predefined type. So here S is a string type. Similarly, here out is a print stream type, and this is also a static variable. So this is the context. So in Java, there is a class called system, predefined class, and inside this there is a variable called as out. This type is print stream, and this is a static variable. Now here, when I say variable as a string, I am applying all the string methods here. Similarly, if this variable is a print stream is also having certain methods like print, println. All the methods are belongs to this print stream. Just like length method is belongs to string, right? Similarly, println methods are belongs to print stream. Okay. Now you guys should tell how to access this out variable. Okay, so Justin Raj is asking question. I was thinking system is a namespace like in C sharp. No, it is a predefined class in Java. Okay, so now how we can access this out variable now? First, class name system dot out is a variable. Now, so as I said earlier in the above example, I can apply all the string methods on top of variable S, right? Similarly, I can apply all the methods which are belongs to print stream. So dot println is a one of the method is available, which is belongs to this print stream class. So what this println will do is, whatever we added in this double quotation as a parameter, that will be printed as an output in your console window. That's the functionality of println. But here length is not printing anything. Length is returning some value. So as I said earlier, the methods may return some value or may not return some value. That is up to our requirement. But here length is returning some value, but here println not returning anything. It is just printing some value, whichever we are providing inside the double quotations. Okay, this is the function of println. Now if you observe the whole statement, system is a class, out is a variable of print stream and static type, and println is a method which is belongs to print stream, and whatever message you have given here, that will be printed as an output. That is done by the println statement, println method. Okay, so this is the context of system.out.println. So if in interview, if anybody asks you, you should explain with this example. Okay, so guys, are you clear now? Why is system.out.println? So what is system? What is out? What is println? Okay, not only println, we have also another method called print. Okay, println will print these messages in one by one. So in the next lines, but print will give you message in the same line, will print output in the same line. So that's the difference. Okay, so this is all about system.out.println. So that's all for today. I'll stop it here and then come to the assignment part. So I have given only one assignment today. Just try this. This is again related to overloading concept. And other examples like this keyword, static examples, you can just try it in my class examples, whatever I have told. And this is a calculation, create a class name called calculations. Inside it, create a few methods, create some method. And these two methods are returning integer also. And it takes two parameters, it returns int. It takes three parameters, it returns int, some of those numbers. And it takes two doubles and returns int, double. And it takes three parameters, all are double, it again returns a double. So all the methods are returning something. So I have given the clear description here for each end method, what this will do. And then create an object for calculation class called cal. And then call all these methods by passing different inputs. Okay. And Navina, just please hold on. I'll talk about that. Okay. So this is a calculation class which contains these methods. Okay. And just call these methods by passing multiple inputs. and get that output in some other variables. Because these methods are returning some value, we have to create multiple variables to hold that values and then print them. Okay, so this is the one assignment you guys can do from today, and rest of them we'll see in the next class. Okay, so that's all for today. If you have any questions, now you can ask me, or else let's meet tomorrow. Okay, so Navina, I'll send you email. Okay, I'll send email. I not confirmed the time. Okay, I'll just send an email to you. Okay. So that's all for today. So bye everyone. So please practice all examples. I will also copy the solution in Google Drive. You can just access it. Okay. So bye everyone. Let's see tomorrow again. Bye for today. So today we are going to discuss about one of the feature of object-oriented programming, that is Java inheritance. So again, method overriding, super keyword, final keyword is also belongs to this concept. So let's start with the Java inheritance. So what is inheritance concept in Java? So normally when you working on some automation keyboard, normally Java developer will write some programs, right? Suppose we have a class called something like this. So this is called as A, class A, and which contains some variables, and also this contains a few methods. Okay, suppose I have created one more class here called as a B, and I want to reuse these variables and methods again in class B. Okay, suppose I want to create a certain functionality. Let's say I have a one feature which is implemented by using these variables and methods, and in class B I want to achieve one more feature, feature 2, let's say feature 2, and if you want to implement this feature 2, I want to do the feature 1 also, because along with the feature 2 is depends on feature 1. So in B, I have created a few more variables and few more methods which are required to achieve this feature 2, or let's say functionality 2. Now in this case, if you want to achieve this feature 2 or functionality 2, we need to have the feature 1 also. So in this case, again these variables and methods we no need to create again in class B. Okay, because we already done in class A. So simply what we can do is we can just extend this class into class B. So extends keyword we have to use here. So what is this extends keyword means? When I acquire, when I say extends B, this B class is become a child class of this class A. So this called class is called as a parent class now. As soon as we extend this class into another class, A is called as a parent class, or it is also called as a super class, and it is also called as a base class. So we can call it any name, so parent class or super class or base class. And whichever class is acquired all the variables and methods from the another class called as child class, or we can call as a subclass or derived class. So these are the multiple names we have. So inheritance is a concept by which we can acquire all the variables and methods from another class. So once we have acquired everything, whatever is belongs to class A, variables and methods, they are also belongs to class B, and we no need to define this, redefine again in class B. We don't require, because class A already done certain functionality, and again we are reusing this A into B. Now B is also having everything from class A. So the main reason to implement this feature is the reusability. So once we have created, we can just reuse this any number of times. Okay, this is the concept of inheritance. So inheritance is basically a concept by which we can acquire all the stuff from one class to another class. So parent class, or we can say child class, or super class, or subclass, or base class, or derived class. So this is the connection between these two classes. Okay, this is a concept. So let me just write a small definition here. So acquiring all the properties from one class to another class is called as inheritance. Not only properties and also behavior. This is a generic definition. From one class to another class called as a inheritance. So just simply like a parent and child relation. Suppose a parent is having certain number of certain property, let us say. So a parent is having a property, let's say a parent is having some properties, so the child is also will get the same property, right? So this is the same concept is implemented as part of an inheritance. So here two important things called as a parent class or a base class, or this is a super class. So whichever class we have our main thing, right? And this is called parent class or base class or super class. And if any other class is acquired everything from this class, we can call it as a child class or a subclass or derived class. Okay, just use one of this name. Okay, don't confuse. You can call this as a parent class or child class. Okay, or a base class or subclass. This is a combination of super class, subclass, or base class or derived class. Okay, we can just call any one of them. Normally I use call as a parent class and child class. Okay, so this is the concept of inheritance. So acquiring all the behavior or properties from one class to another class. So this is called parent class and this is called as a child class. We don't need to redefine again everything. So now this inheritance, we have a 5 types of inheritance. There are 5 types of inheritance. So the one is 5 types of inheritance. So the first one type is a single inheritance, and second one is multi-level inheritance, and the third one is hierarchical inheritance, and fourth one is multiple inheritance, and fifth one is hybrid inheritance. Okay, so these are the 5 types of inheritances we have: single inheritance, multi-level inheritance, hierarchical inheritance, multiple inheritance, and then hybrid inheritance. Okay, let's see first what are those types of inheritances, then we will see implementation part. So this is very simple. So for example, here I have one class called, let's say, A, and if I acquired everything from this class A to class B, okay, there are only 2 classes now. So this is called as a single inheritance. We will have only 2 classes. So let's say A is a one class, B is another class. So if I acquired everything from A to B, this is called as a single inheritance. Okay. And the second one is a multi-level inheritance. So for example, class A, which is acquired everything into B. Now again, I have created one more C class. Now what happens is, here C is the child class of B and B is a child class of A. Similarly, B is a parent of C and A is a parent of B. So here we need to extend, and here also we need to extend, and we can create any number of levels like this: A to B, B to C, C to B. So now what happens is, B acquired everything from A. Now C is also acquired everything from B as well as A. So whatever is belongs to A and B, which is again belongs to C. Okay, so this is called as a multiple inheritance or multi-level inheritance. Multi-level, remember this. Okay, we can create multiple levels. And there is another type of inheritance, hierarchical inheritance. So hierarchical inheritance means, so for example, one class A, we can define any number of subclasses from this class. Let's say this is a B, this is a C, and this is a T. And multiple child classes we have, and there is only one parent class. All these childs are having one parent class. Now what happens is, B acquired everything from A, C is also acquired everything from A, D is also acquired everything from A. But B, C, D are independent. They are nowhere related. Okay, these are three different classes. Okay, and Oris is asking question, can A be a child of both B and C? Yes, that is also one kind of inheritance. Okay, I'll tell you that. So first one is single inheritance. Second one is multi-level inheritance, A to B and B to C. And this is the third inheritance. So here A is a parent class and B, C, D are the child classes. This is called as a hierarchical inheritance. This is called as a hierarchical inheritance. This is the third type of inheritance. And then we have a multiple inheritance. In the multiple inheritance, one child can have multiple parents. One child can have multiple parents. So for example, let's say class A and class B. These are two classes. And I will define one more class based on these two classes. Okay, this is called as a multiple inheritance. This is called as a multiple inheritance. So here one child class can have two parents. Now C is acquired everything from A as well as B. So this is called multiple inheritance. Now there is hybrid inheritance, is a combination of hierarchical plus multiple. Hybrid is a combination of hierarchical and multiple. So how it will be? So for example, class A, and I have derived two classes from A, let's say B and C. Now I'll create one more class called as D, which is acquired from B and C. So in the top portion, it is a hierarchical. This is your hierarchical, and bottom, this is your multiple. This is called multiple inheritance. It's a combination of hierarchical and multiple. This is called as hybrid inheritance. This is called as hybrid inheritance. So these are the five types of inheritance. Okay. And Purashi says, can A be a child class of B and C? Yes. So that is a comes under the multiple inheritance. Okay, so whatever is saying all comes under the multiple inheritance. So in other words, we can say like A be the child class of both and B, B and C. Let's say B and C are the parent classes now. So we can create one child class, right? So this is a comes under the multiple inheritance. Okay, so these are all five types of inheritances we have: single inheritance, multi-level, hierarchical, multiple, then hybrid inheritance. So among those inheritances, in the five inheritances, if you want to acquire everything from one class to another class, we use extends keyword. Okay, extends keyword, and everything is a class here. So A, B, C, D, whatever I have listed here, everything is a class. Okay, extends keyword and everything is a class here. So by using these two, inheritance is possible, and especially single inheritance, multi-level and hierarchical. Okay, so these three inheritances are possible by using this class and extends keyword. But we cannot achieve multiple and hybrid keyword, hybrid inheritance, by using these two ones. So if you want to achieve multiple and a hybrid inheritance, we have to use another concept called as a interface. Instead of class, we have to use interface concept that we'll see in the next section. And instead of extends, we use another keyword called as a implements. This is another combination again. So normal inheritance, we have five types, and single inheritance, multi-level, hierarchical. These three inheritances we can implement or we can do by using class concept and by using extends keyword. But we cannot achieve multiple and hybrid inheritance by using these two. Okay, I'll tell you why. But if we want to achieve this multiple inheritance and hybrid inheritance, we must use or we must go and use interface concept. Interface along with the implements keyword. Okay, so these two we'll see in the next session. And today we'll more focus on the single inheritance, multi-level inheritance, and then hierarchical inheritance. How we can implement this by using class and extends keyword. Okay, so but why it is not possible? Because here one child is having multiple parents, but extends keyword cannot support multiple parents. We cannot extend multiple parents like extend A, extend B, extend C. We cannot do that. Okay, that can be possible by using interface. That's the reason interface come into the picture. Right. So let us see now how we can do this. Let me also share a small presentation. These are types of inheritance. So here, a single inheritance, multi-level, hierarchical, multiple. Here I haven't listed hybrid inheritance because that is a combination of hierarchy and multiple. That's not a different kind of inheritance. It's a combination of both two are called as a hybrid inheritance. Hybrid inheritance. So these are the five types of inheritance. So this is single inheritance, multi-level, hierarchical, and multiple. Now let us see one by one. So if it is a single inheritance, we need to write a syntax like this. So first we'll define one class called A, which contains some variables and methods. And then we'll create one more class called as a B. And by using extends keyword, we can acquire everything from parent class to child classes. As soon as I say extends A, and B is having its own stuff again, but it is also get everything from class A. So that is a single inheritance. Now let's implement this. So what I can do is to implement this inheritance. Okay, so I will just create a new package for today. Just a new package, day 7. Okay, so now, so I will just create a single inheritance first. So what I will do is first I will create a new class. So I will name this as inheritance examples. Okay, so let's have this method and class one side. This is the actual class. So you can also create different files. Classes has the different files here. But here I'm just following approach like one file contains multiple classes. So here I will define a class called as A. Okay, and I'll define something here. So in class A, I will define a variable called int A. Along with this, I will also create a method, let's say void display of, and this method will just print value of A. I'll just write system.out.println. I'll just print the value of A. Okay, this is our method. So class A contains a variable and along with the method. Now I will create a one more class called as a B. Okay, and now I want to make this B as a child class of parent class A. Now I should use extends keyword. This is your extends class A. Okay. So here what happens is as soon as I say extends A, B is a child class of A. Now B is also contains everything from A. Now again, B it also contains its own stuff. So now here I will define a variable called as a B, and I will also write one more method, void print, and this method will print the value of B. System.out.println. I'll just print the value of B. Right. So this is how I need to create single inheritance. So now here B is child class and A is parent class. So this is your parent class and B is a child class. Okay. So this is how we need to do the inheritance concept. Now, so we have acquired everything class A to class B, right? So now come to the main class. So here I want to use these variables and methods in this class, inheritance example class. So how to access these variables or methods from class A and B? So here, suppose if I create an object for class A, so let's say A obj equal to new A. So now what happened? I have just created an object for class A. Now through this object, what are all things I can access now? I can access only the variable A and also display method, because this object is referring to class A, right? This is only class A. Now if you observe A obj dot A, I can access A. So here I will assign some value called 100. Now A obj dot, I can call the display method. That's it. I can call only, I can just call these things like variable A and along with the method. That's it. Suppose let's run this. Okay, now we got the output. So for example, if I want to create class B object, so B, now I'm creating object for class B. So let's say B obj is equal to new B. So now I create an object for class B, and this time what are all things I can access? I can access B, print, along with this I can also access A and display, because B becomes a child class for parent class A. So B is also contains everything from class A, right? So by using this object, we can access everything from class B and also everything from class A. So now when I say here B obj, B obj dot, see now it shows both the variables. See A, and here I'll assign 10, and B obj dot B, so also I can assign, so I'll assign some number B. So by using object of B, I can access everything from parent class as well as child. Similarly, I can also access the methods B obj dot display, but actually this belongs to class A, but still we can access this B obj dot print. Okay, so here this variable also, this variable is belongs to A and this belongs to B, and this belongs to A and this belongs to B, but still we are able to access everything from this object B obj object, because this is actually child class of parent class. So once we created object for child class, we can acquire, we can access everything from parent class and also child class. Now let's comment this part, right? So now let's run this code. Now we'll get the output. So both the methods, both variables have initiated, and then we called both methods. This is called as a single inheritance. So we have only one parent and we have only one child class, right? So this is called as a single inheritance. Now, so I'll discuss the next one, multi-level inheritance. So in a multi-level inheritance, we have a multiple classes like A to B, B to C and everything. So B is acquired everything from class A, C is acquired everything from class B, means B is also have A also, right? So B means here B contains its own stuff along with the A. Now C is acquired from B. Now what happens? Now C is having along with the B, means B plus A. So B contains everything from A, right? So B, if I extend B, C is also get everything from B as well as A. This is called as multi-level inheritance. So the syntax will be like this. Class A is a parent class. Class B extends A. Now class C extends B. Okay, here we need to extend and here we need to extend like this. So we can write any number of levels like this. This is called as a multi-level inheritance. Multi-level inheritance. Now let's implement this. So now I have created two classes, right? And now I will create one more class. So I will just create one more class called as a C, and this one will extends B. Now the C becomes a child class of B. It contains everything from A, B, and I will also define one more variable, integer C, and void, I will write one more method called as a show, and this method will print the value of C, right? So this time I will create an object for C now. So I'll just comment everything. So now I will just create object for C. Class C, C obj equal to new C obj, right? So now C obj dot, see now it's showing all the variables A, B and C. So why? Because this is a chain loss of B. So B is already acquired everything from A. So first access A, and I'll say just 10 COBJ dot B. I'll just add 20. Now COBJ dot C, I will just say 30. Okay, so now we have assigned all three variables by using class C objects. COBJ, sorry, this is C. Just a moment. Okay, and Justin is asking, can we have same method name in all parent and child classes? But that is a different concept, Justin. That comes under the overriding. Okay, that we'll explain in a few minutes. We have that concept. Next concept is that one. Okay, I'll just talk about this. Fine. So this is a basic, just focus on this. Fine. So we have created an object of C, and by using this, we can access all the variables, and then I will call the methods also. So COBJ dot, I will call display method first, and COBJ dot, I will call print method. Then again, COBJ dot, we can call the show method. So three methods are called, right? So now let's run this. So we'll get output of all three methods. Okay. So this is called as a multi-level inheritance. Multi-level inheritance. Okay. So now let's implement the hierarchical inheritance. So first of all, guys, are you clear about single and multi-level inheritance? How we can achieve? So please confirm on the chart window. So by using just extend keyword, it's very simple concept. So we can create any number of classes, as many of you want. So now let's implement the another kind of inheritance, that is a hierarchical inheritance. What is a hierarchical inheritance? We have only one parent class can have multiple child classes, but these child classes are nowhere related. Okay. Suppose in parent class, I defined a method called, I defined a variable called A, and this is again belongs to B, C, and also D. Okay. This is called a hierarchical. And to demonstrate this, I'll create one more class, number D7, new class. I will name it as hierarchy inheritance. Hierarchy inheritance. Right. So now keep this method one side. Now I will create different methods now. So I'm say hierarchy inheritance, right? So let's say create one class called, I'll name directly as a parent, because whatever names I have used in previous classes, we cannot again use the same names for defining new classes. Okay. We should use the different names, because A, B, C already I used in previous class. So I cannot use the same names, because all the classes are belongs to same package. In the same package, we should not have multiple classes with the same name. Okay, remember this. In the same package, we should not have multiple classes with the same name. Even if you take this particular file, we have multiple classes, but different names. So we should always change the names of the class. So here I created one class called as a parent. Right now in this class, I will define something called let's say int A, and again I'll just write the same method, void display, and these are very simple, just understand the concept. Okay, then we will make it as a complex. So beginning level, we need to understand with the simple things. So variable, and it contains a method. So in this method, I will just write A. So this will print that value of A. So this is an actual parent class. Now for this parent, I will create two child classes. I will create a two child class. This is the hierarchical inheritance, A to B, A to C, and A to D, right? So this is a one parent. This is a child class one, child class two, child class three. Now I will create one child class now. Class, I'll directly name it as a child one. and which is extends from parent. Right, so now this child one is acquired everything from parent, and along with this, which contains its own stuff. So I will create a variable called as x, and then I will just print this value void show, and inside this I will just write x. Okay, now we have implemented child one, and which is acquired everything from one parent. Now similarly, I will create one more class which is also acquired everything from the same parent. Let's say child2 extends same parent class. Suppose if I say here child1, that becomes again a multi-level inheritance, right? So here child2 is also extend from the same parent class, but child1 and child2 is a completely different classes. They are nowhere related. So here it's also having its own stuff, let's say int y. Now here I will create one more method void, let's say print, and here I will just write system.out.println of y, right? Print Hello. Fine. So now I have created two child classes, child1 and child2, for the same parent class. Okay, now let's see. I create object for child1 and child2 also, then we will see what are all things I can access. Now come to the main class, and wherever the main method is exist, I call that as a main class, and the file is also should be saved as with this name. Okay, so the file name here, inheritance examples dot, let's this one, hierarchy inheritance dot java, right? So the file name should be same as a this class name. In whichever class is having the main method, we need to save that file as a that particular name, right? So now I will create an object for child1 and child2 also. Now let's say child1, let's say c1 is equal to new child1. So now I created an object for child1 class. So by using this object, what are all stuff I can access? I can access x and show, along with this a and display. So I'll just say c1 dot. See, now it's giving a and x. This is from parent, this is one child1. So let's say a, I'll just say 100. C1 dot, I will also access x, I will make it as a 200, right? So now I will just call those methods also. Again, C1 dot display, C1 dot show. So now when I say an object for child1, I can access the stuff from child1 along with the parent. So now run this. Now it gives the output of two methods. Okay, so Urvashi is asking questions. Can we create these classes within the main class? I mean, no. Every class is different. Okay, so we should not create one class within another class. That syntax itself is will not support. Every class is independent. Okay, so don't confuse here. So here, every class is independent. We should not write like this. Let's say class A. Again, which contains class B. So we should not write like this. Okay, so this is not the way of writing inheritance. So we have to write like this. So this is the way we need to write. Everything is a different class. Okay, but we can extend those class into child classes. This is a concept of inheritance. Okay. Okay, this is a, makes a lot of difference. Okay, that syntax itself will not support. So this is the one we need to do. So always, if you want to use these classes, we must create an object for these classes, and through the objects only we need to access these methods. Fine. So now here I created an object called C1. We have assigned the variables, and also I will just call those methods. Then it gives a output. And similarly, if I create an object for child two, and let's say C2, and say this is your child2 class, right? So now when I create an object for C2, by using this C2, I can access everything from child2 along with the parent. Now C2 dot, you can say A and Y. So A is belongs to parent. I'll just say 100. And C2, Y is belongs to child2. I'll just say 200. And it can just give some different number. I'll just say 10 here. And I'll just say 20. Now I can also call this method. So C2 is having a display method which is comes from parent. And C2 dot, I can just say, what is that method we created? Print. So print method we can call. So now we'll get output from child object 2 also. So 10 and 20. So this is how we need to achieve hierarchy inheritance. So hierarchy inheritance is nothing but all the child classes are having a one single parent class. This is possible. But here, multiple in hybrid, in the both inheritances, there is a scenario. Like one child cannot acquire everything from multiple parents. One child should not have multiple parents. Okay. But this can be achieved by using interface concept, not by using class and extends keyword. Extends keyword cannot support this one. So we cannot write like this. C or extends A, comma extends B. So this syntax will not support. So this can be achieved. These two, multiple and hybrid, can be achieved by using interface and by using implement schema. Okay. So this will be explained in the next session. And for now, just remember these two types of inheritance: single inheritance, multi-level, and hierarchy inheritance. Okay. So once we have done this, let's go for the next concept called method overriding, and then super queue and final queue. So let's discuss about method overriding. This is very important topic. So in the previous sessions, we have seen a concept called method overloading, right? So what is the method overloading? So method overloading means we can create any number of methods with the same name. In one class, we can have any number of methods with the same name, but how we can differentiate them? We can differentiate them by passing different type of parameters and different type of methods. Let's say I have a class called as A. Okay, let's say A is my class. And this class contains any number of methods with the same name. Let's say I created method called M1. Again, I can have same method. Again, I can have same method. Name can be same, but the parameters. So how they are uniquely identified: number of parameters and then data type of parameter should be different. Data type of parameter should be different. This is the context of method overloading that we have seen earlier. So one class can have any number of methods which having same name, but how we can differentiate them? By changing the definition. Definition means number of parameters and data type should be different for each and every method. This is called as overloading, and this can be achieved without inheritance also. Without inheritance also, we can just use the overloading concept. This is fine. Now come to the overriding. See, in overriding, it seems very similar but lot of difference. In overriding, we have a class, and Preeti is asking question, if everything is same, just the return type is different. That is one of the criteria. Preeti, here M1, I have created multiple methods inside this class, right? But suppose when I create an object for A, so let's say A obj, yeah, in method overloading, yes, this is a method overloading I talked about. Okay, so even these methods can return different things. Suppose the M1 method can return void, M1 method which will return some int type, and this will also make a difference. This return type is also make different, but the first priority will be these two. Okay, number of parameters and data type parameters. Okay, and this is method overloading concept. Method overloading, if you want to implement this, we don't need to use the inheritance concept. Without inheritance also, we can do the overloading. Now come to the overriding concept. In overriding, please focus on this. In overriding, let's say I class A, and this class A I created a method, let's say m1, and let's assume that this will take a two parameters. One is int, the second parameter is also int, and I created some body here. Okay, this is my method created within class A. Now I created one more class called as a B. Now this class is extend everything from class A. Let's say this is extends A. So now what happens is B is also acquired everything from class A. Now what does it mean is M1 is also belongs to B. M1 is also belongs to B. But now what I will do is I will redefine this method again in class B. So again I will write the same method, integer and integer. Okay, this is called as overriding. Now observe this carefully. In parent class we have a method called m1 which will take two parameters, integer and integer, both are integer, and the body we have written. Now in the child class, if you want to override this method, when we call this override, overriding means the method name also return type should be same. That means definition we should not change. That's the main criteria of overriding. So in overriding concept, definition should not be changed. That means it should be exactly the same. Suppose in the parent class method is returning void, in child class also should return void. In parent class method one is taking two parameters, in the child class also should take two parameters. If the parent class method will take two integers, this should also take integer. That means the method definition, this one should not be changed. It should be exactly the same, but we must change the body. So here the body will be different, here the logic will be different. This is the body is different. Okay, so if I do like this, this is called as a overriding, method overriding. So what are the rules we should consider in method overriding? The method should, definition should be same. So definition means return type, method name, number of parameters, data type of parameters. So these are all comes under the definition, but we should change this body in the child class. That is called as a overriding, overriding. Okay, for example, if I change the definition, what happens in the class B? If I change the definition, then that considered as a overloading. So that will be considered as a overloading. So now M1 method from class A will be treated as a different method, and M1 method from B will be treated as a different method. If you are changed as a definition, if change your definition of this method, that will be treated as a overloading. But if the definition is exactly the same, but if I change the body in the child class, that will be considered as a overriding concept. And overriding can be achieved only through inheritance. Overriding can be possible only through inheritance, because at least we should have two classes, one parent class, one child class. So whatever method we created in the parent class can be override immediately in the child class. Okay, that's the main prerequisite of overriding. So overriding means we should have two classes, one is parent and one is child, and whatever method we created in the parent class, we should not change the body of that, we should not change the definition of that method in the child class. That's the first thing. And we must change this body in the child class. So that is called as a overriding. Okay, so within inheritance, we can use overriding and overloading. But if you want to use the overloading, inheritance is not at all required. Without inheritance also, we can do overloading. Now you guys should tell, what is the difference between overloading and overriding? So this is an entry question. So what is the difference between overloading and overriding? So I'll tell you. So first difference is, in overloading we should change the definition of the method. We should change the definition, means number of parameters and data type parameter should be different. In those cases we can consider that is overloading. In overriding we must change, we should not change the definition. In overloading we should change the definition, because we should able to uniquely identify those methods. But in overriding we should not change the definition, we should change only the body. Okay, that's the one difference. The second difference is, Overloading can be achieved without inheritance also. We don't need to have multiple classes. Even single class itself, we can create multiple methods by changing the definition. That is overloading. But if you want to achieve the overriding, we must at least have two classes, parent class and child class. Because whichever method we created in parent, so that method we need to override in the child class. Okay, so these are the two differences between overloading and overriding. So guys, are you clear now? What is overloading and what is overriding? So this is a very important question and you people should not confuse this. Okay, so even in inheritance also, we can achieve both. Suppose if I change the definition in the child class, that comes under the overloading. If I don't change the definition, that comes under the overriding. Okay, so remember this. Now let's implement this overriding concept. So if you want to implement this overriding, so what is the use case when this overriding will applicable? I'll just give you one example here. Let's go and see this overriding. Okay, so let's see this particular scenario. Okay, so I have a class called as a bank. This is your parent class. And this is normally hierarchical inheritance. Okay, so this is a bank. And which contains a method called get rate of interest. Get rate of interest. Let's say this is returning some float or double, a decimal number. A rate of interest will be return type. Now I will create multiple classes, multiple child classes for the same bank class. Let's say SBI, ICICI, and then Axis. So I have created multiple classes for the same parent class. Now what happens is the same method again belongs to each and every class. Now within these subclasses, in the child classes, I don't change the definition of this method, but I will change the body of this method. Why I should change the body of this method? Because the rate of interest will be different from one bank to another bank. So this bank rate of interest is different, ICICI rate of interest is different, Axis rate of interest is different. So the method is same. Every bank is having rate of interest, but the data will be different. So the body can be different. So what I'm doing here is I'm overriding this method into child class. Here it will return float some number, but here it will return some different number, and here some different number, and here also some different number. So that will be change in the body itself. So definition we should not change, but we should change the body. Okay, this is a one of the use case of method overriding. So let us implement this. And to implement this, this is basically hierarchical inheritance, right? Because one parent class having multiple child classes. Now let's implement this. So to implement this, we can create one more class. Sorry. Let's view. Okay, so let's open this. So I will create a new class. Okay, so I'll name it as a method overriding example. Method overriding demo. Let's take a main method, finish. Okay, so let's keep this class one side. Now I'll create these two classes. These classes first. These are class and these are the three child classes which will derive from the same parent class. Now I'll create a class called as a bank. Right, so in this bank, I will create a method called as rate of interest. And let us see, this is written a decimal number, let's say a double. Rate interest rates always in the form of decimal numbers, so I'll just return double. And here I'll use a simple return statement, zero. For now it is zero. Okay, this is the method I created in parent class. Let's say interest, rate of interest. So this is one parent class. Now for this parent class, I will create three different child classes for three different banks. Now let's say class SBI, which is extends from a bank. And similarly, I will create one more class ICICI, which is extends from bank. and then I create class access, and it is also extends from the same bank, right? So now I created three child classes. Now I will override this method. Now, if you want to override, we should not change the definition. We should write same thing, but the body we have to change. So let's say the interest rate of SBI is, let's say, 10.5. Okay, so here we should not change the definition. Suppose if the method is also having some parameters, we should not change those parameters. We should be writing exactly the same. This is called overriding concept. Now here also it's the same, but the rate of interest will be different. And here it is also same, but here I can say it .5. Okay, so now I have changed the body of those methods in child classes. Now come to the actual main class. Okay, so this is the actual is a main class, right? Method overriding examples. Now here I'm not extending anything with this. So come to the main method. So if I create an object for the SBI, and when I call this rate of interest, it will return 10.5. So let us see now. So first I will create an object for SBI class. Let's say SBI is equal to new SBI. So here this SBI is a class name. This SBI is the object name, small letters. Now when I call this method by using this SBI dot get rate of interest, SBI dot rate of interest. So this will return some value, right? So I can just put that into system dot out dot println. Because so normally we should hold that value in some variable and then we can print it. But instead of using other variable, I can just print in my console by using system.out.println. So this time this will return actually this one from SBI class. Now same thing I'll repeat. So this time I will just create let's run this first. So which method will be executed this one? So we created an object for SBI. So whichever method we created in SBI, so that even though it is extend bank, so it is extend bank means this method is again belongs to SBI. But we have overrided this method. So once we overrided this method, the latest method will be executed. So it will not consider the old one. So it should return 10.5. So let's run this. It's written 10.5. Okay. And similarly, I will also create an object for ICICI is equal to new ICICI. So now ICICI dot rate of interest. Now what this will return? This will return 9.7. This is from ICICI bank. Now let's print this. Right. So run this. We'll get output as a 9.7. So whichever method we called from that particular class will be executed. And the last one is we have access bank here. So new access, right? So by using this object, I can again call the same method create of interest. Now put this into method system dot out dot println access dot rate of interest. So now it will give you three different interest rate for the from the three different banks. So this is a concept of overriding. So the same method which is defined in the parent class is again overrided in child classes according to their requirement. So always when you do some overriding concept, we must change the body. Okay, so if you don't change the body, it will be treated as the same. That will not be the overriding. So in overriding, method definition should not be changed, but the body of the method should be changed. Okay, remember this. So this is called as a overriding, overloading and overriding. So in overloading, we should change the definition, but in overriding, we should not change the definition. Similarly, in overloading, without inheritance also we can do that. But in overriding, we must have at least two classes. One is parent and one is child class. So through inheritance only we can achieve overriding concept. Fine, so if I run this, you will get all the output from all three methods. Okay, so this is a concept of overriding. So what is overriding means? Overriding means we can just redefine the methods, same method in the child classes. That's the concept of overriding. Okay, right? So rewrite the methods in child classes. So here we need to, definition should not be changed. Method definition should be same, and body should be changed. Okay, so this is the rule. These are the rules of writing overriding concept. Right. So guys, are you clear? Method overriding, very important interview question. You guys should be able to answer this. Okay. So Preeti is asking questions. So why did we inherited it if we are changing it? So the base class method has not been used anywhere. Yes. So suppose tomorrow, if I want to add a few more methods, I can just add them in the base class. Okay. So because the same definition we are using every class. Okay. So this class we haven't used here anywhere, but this parent class is a base for every child class. So suppose tomorrow if I add some other method here, that is also belongs to this one, because all the banks are same, functionality is also same, but little different. Like for example, this rate of interest is different, but method is same. Every bank is having rate of interest is same, but the method is different. Okay, suppose the bank is providing some loans. So here I'll create one more method called as a loans. But what kind of loans are providing SBI, that will be different. And what kind of loans are provided by other bank, it can be different. So here the main concept is, if I define something in parent class, we can again redefine the same in child classes. We can redefine the same thing in child classes according to your requirement. If I don't have that requirement, you don't need to do that. Okay, so in child class, I want to use the same method. Okay, so in that case, we can just change the body. You don't need to create any other method. You don't need to create any other method for this. You're already there in the parent class. We can just use the same method in the child class, but just change that body. You don't need to create any other method. So basically, this will reduce our code. This will reduce a lot of code. And reusability concept is achieved. Reusability concept is achieved. So that's the main intention of overriding concept. Okay. Even though if you are not using this base class, these child classes are using this base class. Okay. The child classes are using this base class. That's the main intention of it. So I have just taken an example to demonstrate the overriding. So how to override the methods. So in the parent class should have a method. The same method again will recreate in child classes by changing the body of those methods without changing the definition. So that is the concept of overriding concept. Okay. So is it clear, everyone? So even though if I don't use this base class, the child classes are using the base class, but in the main class we haven't created an object for this, but still all the child classes are derived from the same base class. So that is the use of this base class. This is indirect use. You are not directly use it, but all the child classes are using this base class. So that's the reason we should have this base class. Bank is a base class. Okay. So now, is it clear, everyone? So overriding concept. We'll see so many examples in future. So we'll be very clear about it. Okay, where this can be applicable and not. Overriding is very important concept. Right, so now let us see next one. Super keyword and finally keyword. So can you guys please confirm on the chat window? If you're still not clear, please let me know. I'll give few more examples. Okay. Okay, so now let's go for another one called as a super keyword and final keyword. So let us see a super keyword and final keyword. First, let us talk about the super keyword, where we can use this super keyword. So especially this super keyword is used only in inheritance concept. So final can be used anywhere, but super keyword can be used only within inheritance, mostly in inheritance. Now let us see where we can use this super keyword. So super keyword can be used in three different ways. One is, let me just write the notes here. This is the first use. So super keyword can be used to refer immediate parent class instance variable. I'll tell you in detail. And super can be used to invoke immediate parent class method. And super keyword can be, this is not keyword, this is a method, can be used to invoke immediate parent class constructor. So these are three different uses of super keyword. Let me describe this. Super can be used to refer immediate parent class. What is this immediate parent class? What is the meaning of immediate parent class? So the immediate parent class means like this. So I have a class like this, A and B and also C. Now for C, B is an immediate parent class. So for C, B is also parent, A is also parent, because C is acquired everything from B as well as A. But B is an immediate parent class. This is called as an immediate parent class for C. Okay. So the first point is super keyword can be used to refer immediate parent class instance variable, immediate parent class instance variable. And similarly, super can be used to invoke immediate parent class method. Super can be also used invoke immediate parent class constructor. In all three ways, all the three scenarios, we are talking about immediate parent class. Okay, so let us see how we can use this and super keyword. The first one is, we can see super keyword can be used to refer immediate parent class instance variable. Immediate parent class instance variable. So let me demonstrate this. So to demonstrate this, I will just create one class. Let's create a class called just a moment. Okay, I'll just name it as a animal. Okay, my class name is animal. I don't take a main method because just simply it is a class. I'm not putting main method here. So in this class, I will just write a variable. Let's say a string. I'll just say color. Animal is having certain color. Let's say a white. Okay, this is a color of the variable. And this is a variable, right? This is the color of the variable. Simply just have only one color equal to white. This is one class. So now I will just create one more class called as a test super. Let me just create one more class. Testing super keyword. Let's have one. And this class I will take main method. Now observe this. So this is one class which contains a variable, right? So string color is equal to white. Okay, string color is equal to white. And here we have another class called test super, which contains the main method. So what I can do is here, along with this white, I will also create one more method. Okay, so I will just create, okay, so let it have it. I will create one more class here. Class called let's say a dog, and this class is extends animal class. This class is extends animal class. Okay, now what I can do is I will just redefine the same variable again here. Just a moment. Okay, so here I will just redefine the same variable. So this is also an overriding. So, but here I will just give some different color called as a black. Okay, so now parent class contains a variable called color white. Now this class is extended into another class called as a dog, but here I have override this variable. Now along with this, I will also create a method here. Let's say void display color. I write a display color method. So here I will write system dot out dot println. I'll just say color. Okay, this is my situation. And Justin Uroshi is asking access modifier not needed in front of class dog. That is up to you, Uroshi. If you want to put public, that class can be accessed anywhere. If I don't put any access modifier, that will be treated as a default. Okay, so default is also one of the access modifiers. If I don't specify anything, that will be considered as a default access modifier. You can just put public, nothing wrong in this. Okay, fine. So I have created an animal class which contains a variable called as a color. The value of this is white. Now immediately I created one child class called as a dog, which is extended from animal class. Now here I have just override this variable with a different value. Now when I call this display color, okay, now this is the actual class. Now come to the main class. So I have created main class as a different file this time. Okay, so in the main class I create an object for dog. Let's say D new dog. Okay, now you guys should tell if I say dog does display color, so what is an output you will get. So here I created object for D, that means dog, and I call the display color. So this will automatically call this method, and internally I printed the value of color. Okay, so I printed the value of color. So B dog is already extended from animal, right? So this variable is also belongs to this one, but we have overrided with the new value here. So what happens here is when I call display method, it will call this one and it will print the color. So in this color variable, whichever is the latest value, that will be printed as an output. Okay, so in this case we must get the color as a black. Now if I run this main class, you will get an output as a black. This is our expected value. But for example, I want to capture the value of immediate parent class variable. So what is immediate parent class for this dog? Animal is an immediate parent class. So I want to capture this value. Instead of this value, I want to retrieve the parent class value, parent class variable value, immediate parent class variable value. How we can get it? If I want to get this, we have to use super keyword, super dot color. Now what this keyword will do is it will go and capture the value of immediate parent class variable. Okay, now when I run this, this will give you white also. Along with this black, it will also give you white. So this particular statement will point to the immediate parent class variable. So that's the first usage. Now you read the statement, you can understand. Super can be used to refer immediate parent class instance variable. So what is the instance variable? This is the instance variable of immediate parent class. Now here we use super keyword to refer immediate parent class variable. Okay, suppose if I don't use this super keyword, normally it will take the latest value, but if I use super, it will consider or it will take the immediate parent class variable. That's the first usage of super. So super can be used to refer immediate parent class instance variable. Okay, so guys, are you clear this first point? So how we need to use the super to refer immediate parent class instance variable, right? So this is a simple example. Now let's go to the second one. Second one, super can be used to invoke immediate parent class method. Invoke immediate parent class method. Super keyword can be used to refer immediate parent class method. So for example, here I will also add one more method here in the parent class. So I will write a void, let's say eating. This is our method. Inside the method I will write system dot out dot println. I will just write some method called as eating. Okay, I'm not mentioning what it is, just eating. Okay, this is a method I created in the parent class. Now I will override this method in the child class. Now, so let display color, let it be having. So along with this, I will just create the same method again in the child class. Now here I will just change the body. So eating, I just said bread. Eating bread. So what I have done is I have just overrided this method into child class, because just definition is same. I have just modified the body. Okay. So for now, I will just disable this display color method. Right. So now let's see the second point. So super can be used to invoke immediate parent class method. Immediate parent class method. Remember this. Now come to the main class. So now what I have defined is, in a parent class we have a eating method. Now don't forget about this variable. Okay, now let's focus on the method. So in the parent class we have a method called as eating, and the child class also we have the same method eating, but the body is different. Okay, now when I create an object of dog here D, and I call D dot eating. Okay, so what could be the output for this call? Can anyone guess what is an output for this? So when I call D dot eating, which method it will call? This automatically call the latest method. This is method is overrided in the dog class, right? So it will give you eating bread. This is perfectly right. Fine. So now what my requirement is, I want to invoke the immediate parent class method. Okay, so I want to invoke the immediate parent class method, this one. So how we can invoke this? I can invoke this by using super keyword. Let's say super dot eating. Super dot eating. Now what happens is, when I call this eating method from here, first it will print this one, eating bread, and then this one will refer to the immediate parent class method. Super dot eating means it will go up, and here it will execute this method. Okay, so here the context is, super can be also used to invoke immediate parent class method. But in the first example we have seen, it is invoked immediate parent class variable, but this time I'm talking about immediate parent class method. Immediate parent class method. Now let's run this. Now you can see eating, this is also coming from the parent class method. So that means the super keyword can be also used to invoke parent class method. Okay, so that is another use of super keyword. So one is to invoke or refer immediate parent class variable, or it can also use to invoke immediate parent class method. So that's the second usage of super. This is a keyword. Okay, just we can use a keyword. And super is also can be used to invoke immediate parent class constructor. Immediate parent class constructor. So what I will do is, I can just comment this. This time I will write a constructor. Okay, now so in the parent class I will write a constructor. How to write a constructor? Constructor should be same name as a class, right? So here I will create animal. This is my constructor. So in this constructor, I will just write a small message, system.out.println. So here I will just write animal is created. Some message I have created in constructor. This is a constructor. So name of the constructor should be same as a class name. Fine. So now in the child class also I will create one constructor. So here if I create one constructor, the name should be same as a dog class, right? So I'll create a constructor called as a dog, and here I will write system.out.println. Here I'll just say dog is created. Okay, this is a constructor. Child class we created one more constructor. So now parent class is having one constructor, but constructor name should always same as a class name. So that's the reason in the parent class I given animal, and the child class I have given as a dog. Now when I create an object for D, at the time of object creation itself the constructor will be invoked, right? So that we already know about it. So here I created an object for dog class. So which constructor will be invoked? Can anyone guess? which constructor will be invoked? When I say dog d is equal to new dog, so as soon as I created this one, so it should invoke one constructor. But in the dog class, we have one constructor, and dog is also extended this class animal, right? So when I execute this, it will give you both outputs. So what does it mean is, it is executed or it is invoked dog class constructor, and also it is invoked animal constructor, which is come from the parent class, because dog is already acquired everything from animal class. So both have been executed. Animal is created, dog is created. So both constructor are invoked at the time of object creation. Okay. So for example, here in the dog itself, if you want to invoke the parent class constructor from here, okay, from here, I want to invoke the parent class constructor. So how we can do that is, I can invoke this by using super keyword. So how to do this? Just use super. That's it. We don't need to specify any name of the constructor. Just add a super in the dog. So what it is giving, constructor call must be the first statement. Okay. So this cast statement must be the first statement. Okay. Then we need to write the rest of the statements. Now observe this. So here, when I call this dog object, immediately dog constructor will be executed. But inside this, if I want to invoke this one, parent class, immediate parent class constructor, then I should use super keyword here. But here, this time we need to add brackets. Okay. So super keyword can also be used to invoke parent class constructor, that is animal. There's a parent class constructor. From the child class, we are invoking the parent class constructor. So here dog is a constructor of child class, and here super is a keyword. This will invokes parent class constructor. Parent class constructor. Okay. Now let's see now. So what is an output we will get now? Three outputs we will get. Sorry, two outputs. So one is animal is created. When I call this, immediately dog method is executed. Okay. And here we call super keyword, right? So when I say super keyword, it go and executed this animal constructor from the parent class. So that's the reason this time it comes, animal is created first. And then the dog constructor is executed. So this is the output message we are getting here. So what is the difference between previous one and this one? Let me just comment this. Now you try. So same thing, right? So animal is created. First one executed this constructor, animal constructor. Now the second constructor is executed, dog constructor. Even if you use this super keyword, okay, so this will invoke the immediate parent class constructor. Now again run this code, and again it will execute first animal is created, that means parent class constructor, and also child class constructor. Okay, so this is also used for invoking the parent class constructors if you require. Yeah, same thing. Okay, there is not much difference. Okay, both are same thing. So super keyword is also can be used to invoke the parent class, but a small difference is here. But here in the first method, I have just created an object here. So from here itself, it is invoking the both the constructors. One is from child class and another is from parent class. Both are invoking from here. But when I say super, this time, the parent class constructor will invoke it from this particular method. So from this particular constructor, because we created the super keyword inside the constructor, right? So first it will call this constructor, and then super keyword call the parent class constructor, then it will execute this one. So that's a execution wise, it is different internally, but the output wise, there is no difference. Okay, so this is another usage of a super keyword. There are three purposes. One is super can be used to refer immediate parent class constructor, and this is the same usage, Justin. If you want to invoke the parent class constructor, we can just use this super keyword in the child class constructor. Okay, in the child class constructor, we use this because from here we invoke this parent class constructor. So here itself it is used. Here itself it is used. Even though if I don't use here, if I call like this, you can still do it. So this constructor will be invoked, right? So even if you remove this, here this will invoke. So dog d is equal to new dog will be invoked this constructor from the child class. Now when I execute this, it will also give the same thing. So animal is created, dog is created. That means it is executed the parent class constructor and child class constructor because we have extended the parent class. This approach is different because we are invoking the both the constructors through single object. But here why I have to use super? If you want to invoke the parent class constructor through child class constructor, so then super come into the picture. Okay, the output is same, the internal approach is different. If you want to invoke the parent class constructor through child class constructor, then we need to use super here. We cannot just specify the animal like this. Okay, this is not the correct way of specifying this. So if you want to invoke this parent class constructor through this constructor, and then I must specify this super keyword. Okay, this is how we need to use here, but not from here. Okay, so here it you can see the difference from not from the main method. So the super method is also can be used to invoke immediate parent class constructor. Okay, so remember this very important concept. Now we have discussed about super keyword. Now let us go for the last one called as a final keyword. This is also very important. Next one is a final keyword. So what is this final keyword? So final keyword can be used to define a variable. For example, when I say a variable called int is 10, right? So this variable value can be changed later. Suppose if you want to change this value, you can simply say a is equal to 20, right? So this value can be changed. But if I say that variable as a final, it will not allow you to change this value. What does that mean is final is nothing but a constant. We cannot change that value of that variable. That's the basic purpose of final. So if you want to restrict, if you should not change this value in future, if you want to restrict that variable like that, we should specify the final keyword. That means the value of this variable cannot be changed in future. But not only this, there are three usages of this final keyword. So final keyword can be applied for variable, and final keyword can be applied for method and also class. So it's having different purposes. If I use the final keyword for variable, that variable value we cannot change. But if I apply for final for method and class, what is the effect we will get? Okay, that we will see now. So there are three things we have that we need to remember here. So final keyword can be used in three different ways, right? So if I apply the final keyword for the variable, you cannot change the value of that variable. You cannot change the value of the variable. So this is the first rule. If you apply the final keyword for a variable, the value of that variable cannot be changed. That's the first thing. Now let's show you. Let me just create one more class. Okay, so here I'll just name it as a final variable. Final variable demo. Let's take a main method finish. Okay. So when I say a variable as a final, that variable value we cannot change. That's the first rule. Okay, so let's see. I'll create a global variable here at the class level. Int, just say speed. And is equal to, let's say, 40. Okay, so this is a variable and a number I have assigned. So this is a normal variable. So if you want to change this value, we can still change it. Okay, so this value we can change it. So where we can change this value here, we can access this class name. If I want to access this variable, I must create an object for this class here. Final variable demo, let's say fm is equal to new final variable demo. I just created an object by using this fm dot speed. I can just change this value to 100 and then I can just print this value. Okay, so I can just print system dot out dot println, right? Println fm dot speed. I can just print that value here. Okay, so observe this. I have created a variable called as a speed, which contains a number called 40. But here in the class, after creation of object, I have changed that value. I make it as a 100. Now, when I run this code, this will give you 100, perfectly fine. But I want to make this variable should not change by any other objects. So what I could do is I can just say this is the final. Final. So as soon as you set the final, it start giving an error here. So what it is saying, the final field, final variable demo.speed cannot be assigned. Cannot be assigned. That means we cannot modify that value. And what suggestion it is giving, remove final modifier of speed. So it is asking us to remove this final, then it is allowed us. So this will give you compile time error. Compile time error means it gives the red line. We cannot execute our code. This is incorrect. So what we understood based on this is if I say a variable as a final, the variable value we cannot change. That is a constant. This is a final variable. So we cannot change this value. Okay. This is the first usage of final keyword. Now, final keyword is also can be used for method. So if I create a final method, what happens? So if I say a method as a final, the method cannot be override in the child classes. Method cannot be override in the child class. That is another usage. If I say a method as a final, the method cannot be override in the child class. Okay, so let's see the example. So if I create a method as a final, the method we cannot override in the child classes. Let me just create one more. I will just say final method demo. Final method demo. Let's take a main method. So if I say a method as a final, that method we cannot override. Let me just create a class here. Let's say class, I'll name it as a bike. Okay, so I'll just create one method here, void run. So in this method I will just write system.out.println, and this is I'll just say only running. Okay, so now I have created a method within the bike class. Now if I create a child class, let's say class Honda, which extends bike class. So observe this carefully. So now Honda is a subclass of or child class of bike class because we extended this class. Now we can override this method here, right? So we can just override. You can just change something like instead of running, it's just a started. So I have changed the body. So this is perfectly right. So in the parent class, we have a method, and child class, we have overrided this method. Perfectly right. But if I want to restrict this overriding, I can just say a method as a final. So as soon as I given this final, here it giving the error. So you cannot override final method from bike. So what's the suggestion it is giving? Just remove final modifier of bike. So when I say a method is a final, we cannot override that method in the child classes. That is the usage of final keyword with the method. So here this is a final method. So we cannot override this method in child class. So that's the reason here it is giving compile time error. Compile time error. Okay, this is another usage of final. So to restrict the levels, access levels. Suppose if I provide this class to some other guy, okay, he created an object and he can use all your methods. Suppose some methods you don't want to give to that guy. So what you can do is you can just make it as a final. So he cannot override all these methods. Okay, so final keyword can be also used with method. So in those cases, we cannot override that method in the child class. That is another usage of final. So we have seen two uses. One is if I use that final keyword for the variable, that variable we cannot change that value. We cannot change that value of the variable. So that means that's a constant. And if we apply final keyword for the method we cannot override into child classes. We cannot override them into child classes. Similarly, if I say a class is a final, the class we cannot extend into another class. If I say a class is a final, so that class cannot be extended into another class. Suppose I want to restrict my access level. So I have created my class. I don't want to extend this class into any other child classes. So then what should I do? I should just change a class as a final. Now you can say this class is a final. Now here it is giving error here. See, now the type Honda cannot be subclass the final class bike. So first of all, here itself it is not allowing to extend the bike class into child class because we said a class is a final. Okay, so if the class is a final, that class we cannot override into child class. Okay, so that's another example. Let me just create one more example, then you can, you guys can practice. Okay, so let me just create one more. Final class demo. Okay, so what is the final usage of class? If I create a class with final, let's create a class called bike one. Okay, this is a class. So let's say I have one variable and some methods. Okay, normal. So now I will create one more chain class called class Honda one. Now I'm trying to extend this class. Extends. So here it is fine. No issue at all. Class Honda one extend. Extends bike one. So here no issue with this, no error also. So here we can extend this bike one into Honda one class. But when I say bike is a final class, and we cannot override here, so we cannot extend the class first of all. Okay, so here the class is final. This is our final class, so we cannot extend into child class. So this will throw compile time error. Okay, so these are the three different purposes of final keyword. So remember this: if a variable is a final, the value we cannot change, that is constant. If a method is a final, that method we cannot override into child classes. And if a class is a final, that class we cannot extend into another child class, any other child classes. Okay, so that's the main purpose of final keyword for variable, method and class. Okay, so is it clear everyone? So how to use this final keyword for variable, method and class, right? So that's all for today. I'll just stop it here and I'll give some assignment here. I'll send this presentation. You guys can go through it. I've covered everything. Now final methods and assignment. So this is just to use inheritance concept and create one class called as a teacher, which contains a variable, two variables and one method called as a does. So inside this does method, just write the system.out.println and teaching. And once you created this class, just create one more class as a child class, that is computer teacher. And within this class, just extend this teacher class. Okay, and then we'll get all the variables and methods, and then create an object for this create one more main class, and then create objects for computer class, computer teacher class, and then try to access these variables and this particular method. Okay, this is basically use the inheritance concept. You guys should do, let's say, create teacher class. Okay, and create all these variables and methods here. And then create one more class called as a computer teacher, right? And extends teacher class. Now here, just use this variable, can be override this variable, and then create a main class, and then create an object for this child class and access all the variables and methods. Okay, so just try this as an assignment and inheritance. And rest of the things we'll see tomorrow. And the rest of two types of inheritances we will discuss tomorrow. So this one, so multiple and hybrid can be achieved only through inheritance through interface concept, because extension class doesn't support multiple. So that's the reason we have another concept called as an interface. Okay, so that we'll see tomorrow. So that's all for today. If you have any questions, now you can ask me. I'll just stop it here.